That's a bit better. Thank you very much. That's good. Good morning and welcome to the second meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2024. The first item on our agenda is an evidence session with the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills on the Budget 2024-2025 and on education reform. It's a pleasure to have you back, Cabinet Secretary. And alongside the Cabinet Secretary today are Andrew Watson, Director for Children and Families, Sam Anson, Deputy Director, Workforce, Infrastructure and Digital, and Stuart Gregg, Head of Reform Division. We welcome you all here today and thank you for your time this morning. Can I now invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a brief opening statement on the Budget 2024-2025 before we move to questions from members. Cabinet Secretary, do you have up to 3 minutes? Thanks.
Convener, Happy New Year to you and to the committee. And thank you for the invitation to speak today about the Education and Skills Budget. As members will know, the overall context for this budget has been extremely challenging, with high inflation continuing to place extreme pressure on public finances. And that is on top, of course, of more than a decade of UK government underinvestment that has left our public services with very little resilience. Now, within my own portfolio and across, of course, wider Scottish Government, we've had to take decisions to protect priorities aligned with our three missions of equality, opportunity and community, whilst also ensuring financial sustainability. And it is against that challenging backdrop, therefore, that I am pleased that the Education and Skills Budget has increased in resource by £128 million, or 4.3%. The capital and resource budget combined has increased by almost £121 million in cash terms, so 3.4%. We continue to invest, of course, in high-quality funded early learning and childcare and wider family support. And overall, the government will invest £1 billion in high-quality funded ELC in the next year. We remain committed to keeping the promise to Scotland's care experience, children and young people, and we will continue our delivery of the whole family wellbeing programme. We are fully funding our commitment to pay staff in the private, voluntary and independent sectors, delivering ELC and children's social care with £12 an hour. And we're investing over £387 million in our teaching workforce. That includes £145 million to maintain teacher numbers, as well as £242 million as part of the teachers' pay settlement, making Scottish teachers the best paid in the UK. In addition, with our investment of £1 billion in the Scottish Attainment Challenge over the course of this Parliament to support closing the poverty-related attainment gap. Finally, we remain committed to supporting a high-quality post-school education, research and skills system with over £2.4 billion of investment. However, this is not to diminish the extremely challenging backdrop to this budget. And like every Cabinet Secretary, I have had to prioritise legal and contractual obligations in determining how to deploy this budget. Throughout the budget process, I have deliberately sought to protect those who are most disadvantaged. An example of this is the Scottish Government's commitment to supporting families with the provision of free school meals at this time of financial uncertainty. Now, we are starting with the expansion of our offer to those in receipt of the Scottish Child Payment during this year, with budget also provided for the infrastructure needed for this delivery. Similarly, we will invest £10 million of capital in targeted device and connectivity provision for our most disadvantaged households with children. That will bring in a range of different benefits for families struggling with the cost of living crisis, whilst also tackling digital exclusion amongst our most deprived learners. This approach will enable access not only to digital tools and resources for learning, but also to digital society and online public services, expanding the impact of that investment beyond learners to their wider families. Convener, this is a budget that protects education spending throughout the lifetime of a child's education, despite the headwinds of decisions taken by the UK government. Scotland is the only part of the UK to offer 1,140 hours of eligible funding ELC for all 3- and 4-year-olds, and for all eligible, rather, 2-year-olds, regardless of their parents' working status, putting children first. We have the highest level of spending per pupil in the UK, with the highest number of teachers for every pupil. All primary school pupils in primaries 1 to 5, all children in special schools and eligible pupils in primary 6 through to secondary 6 can benefit from free school meals in Scotland, the most generous national offer of any nation in the UK, saving families on average £400 per child per year. Those who need the greatest support will receive it, including through our investment of £1 billion over the course of this Parliament to close the poverty-related attainment gap. And following on from that, we are taking action to support our colleges, universities and skills system with over £2.4 billion of investment. So for those wishing to move into higher education, our long-standing commitment to free tuition remains unwavering, saving students in Scotland nearly £28,000 and ensuring the ability to learn remains predicated on the ability to learn and not on the ability to be. Convener, I will finish there, but I very much look forward to discussing this budget settlement in more detail with you this morning.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, and I know all the topics that you've mentioned there, I'm sure they'll be brought up in the session as we progress through. Can we kick off questions this morning from Michelle Thompson, please?
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you for attending panel as well. Before other members come in on the budget, I wanted to discuss briefly public sector reform, which was quite extensively pre-tailed, but the budget itself didn't contain any specific plans for how that would happen. Now, I appreciate it's complex and challenging, and there's a real cost associated with it. And I understand the approach thus far is for agencies themselves, some 129, to look at where they could make improvements, which arguably is perhaps like asking turkeys to vote for Christmas. So I wanted to explore with you what your understanding of the approach that's being taken from your portfolio perspective. Is it top down, or will it be working in alignment with you? In which case, how will you be able to dovetail the education reform programme, which is extensive enough, with the wider public sector reform?
I thank the member for her question. I think she raises a hugely important point, particularly in light of the challenges the government faces, which are well known to the committee in relation to DfM's update to Parliament, of course, at the end of last year. And of course, my portfolio is not insulated from those challenges. I do think we have worked quite hard to protect the education budget as best possible. And my understanding of the public sector reform that will need to take place is that all organisations will need to play a role in that. All of our public sector bodies will have to play their part. I think we need to take a nuanced approach to that. That will be easier for some public bodies than it may be for others, given the services that they deliver. And we need to be mindful of that. I am acutely mindful of that, given some of my responsibilities to these organisations and the services that they deliver. So, for example, our qualifications organisation. The member touched on education reform. I know, Convener, we're going on to another session following the budget topic on that very issue. And I'm mindful of the need to support education reform, which is why, of course, the budget contains additionality. I think just over £12 million to help support the reform process itself. But I accept we will need to work very carefully with these organisations. What the DfM set out at the end of last year was that this will be a 10-year plan, that we will look across government to reduce spend, bluntly, and to look at where there are efficiencies to be made across the piece. But all organisations will have to be part of that drive. But I do think, to the member's specific point, we will have to take a nuanced approach. And I think the way in which the budget has been delivered takes that nuanced approach. It protects certain services, whether that's health or education, through the three missions approach. And that's what I would seek to do through reforming these public bodies within the education and skills portfolio, that we remember the impact that education can have. It's not just about the spend in relation to education itself, it's actually a preventative spend too that can benefit other portfolio areas.
I've got a couple of follow-on questions. In terms of just pure delivery, if we knew the deadline was 10 years hence and there was no electoral cycles, the approach that one would choose to adopt, and indeed public pressure, I should say, might be different to where there's intervening events such as elections. So in terms of this nuanced approach and the pressure there will be for demonstrable delivery, how are you going to be able to square that off, Cabinet Secretary, where people will be crying for real evident change but with a nuanced approach against a 10-year delivery? Or perhaps you can just reflect on some of the complexities within that you see.
Well, I can't get rid of electoral cycles, fortunately, because we don't live in a dictatorship, and I think that's a good thing. But I think we do need to be pragmatic, and that's, I suppose, a political challenge for all parties, not least my own, who are currently in government, but for the government of the day in 10 years' time too. So we all need to be mindful that the trajectory that the Scottish Government operates in means that we have to operate with a balanced budget, and we need to have that forecast, I think, in relation to the savings that are need to be taken across government. The member makes specific points in relation to education. I think the DfM is going to set out more detail on this, of course, at stage one. but more than happy to hear suggestions that members might have in relation to how that should operate. I mean, my own personal view as Cabinet Secretary for Education is that we do need to protect the education budget as best possible. I think the budget settlement that we have has done so, but we need to be mindful of the investment in education not just being about my portfolio area. And throughout the budget process, of course, every Cabinet Secretary is keen to make those points. But I do believe an investment in education is a preventative investment that can actually help to alleviate pressures elsewhere in other portfolio areas. And I think that needs to be better understood through the public service reform agenda, recognising that, you know, if we were to take from certain parts of my portfolio, there may be unintended consequences for other parts of government. So actually, the invest to save option that I know the DFM is also pursuing, I think gives us an opportunity to do things quite radically different in an education space. I know on the reform agenda, and again, we'll talk about this later, Mr Day was at committee last week talking about some of his work. I think there's much more opportunity for us in education to have a holistic approach to reform that will help to drive efficiencies, but will also help to improve outcomes for our young people.
And thank you for that. And you're right, we are going to come on to that. And so just following on from it, in terms of a lean to the budget, there's not a specific public sector pay policy that's been published. So how will you be able to support agencies struggling to set budgets and, as I commented earlier, where there's a real cost to the savings that they need to make? What do you see as your role in supporting them without this kind of framing of a public sector pay policy?
Well, I don't think at this time in the financial year we would usually have published our public sector pay policy. So in budgets of the past, it's not the case that we would have published it at this stage in the day. However, I recognise the need to work with these agencies, these organisations. We did so last year. We've done so in years previously. If I had been at the committee this time last year, I would have been in front of the Transport Committee talking about some of the challenges we were facing in relation to ScotRail at that time. We work with that organisation around about the confines of public sector pay for that organisation in setting their approach to resolving a pay dispute at that time. So we will continue to work with the organisations that we support. But bluntly, there is significant financial pressure on this year's budget, financial pressure that I don't think the government has ever faced, and that has been compounded by inflationary pressures. And we all need to be mindful of that, and that includes our public bodies in relation to what that will mean about the offers they're able to make this year in relation to public sector pay. But I don't want to say too much on public sector pay policy, because yeah, that sits out with my remit.
Absolutely fair dues, but I suppose just finally, I wanted to just explore a wee bit more. I mean, I absolutely agree with the constraints on pay and the difficulty of the budget, but it's how specifically you'll be able to support agencies in squaring off that circle, to use a horrible analogy, if I could, because they will be required to deliver to budget exactly the same as the Scottish Government and make these changes at the same time and manage the very real issues with cost base that they have. So my question really is about how you see your role of supporting these agencies with these conflicting demands almost.
So it's quite a general question, and I suppose I gave the transport example as the one that came to mind as a very specific example of a role that I've played in government in bringing about a resolution to that dispute. And we worked with ScotRail at that time to bring about a result in relation to that. You know, my view as Cabinet Secretary will be very much to support these agencies in trying to square what will be a hugely challenging financial settlement for them. I recognise that. It's a hugely challenging settlement for government too, and that's meant that I've had to make some pretty tough and not particularly nice choices in relation to the prioritisation of budget. And you know, in an ideal world, I'm not sure that those are choices that any Cabinet Secretary would want to take. And I'm sure members around the table will be sitting in front of other committees hearing Cabinet Secretaries say similarly. I do think through this budget we've been able to best protect education. I recognise the point the member makes. What I would say is that I will continue to work with these organisations in supporting them to bring about resolutions. But obviously we don't yet have a public sector pay position, so I don't want to prejudge the outcome of that. But any Cabinet Secretary would tell you, and I will say the same, that in my experience working with these organisations to bring about resolutions, but actually to ensure that they can deliver reform, which we will go on to talk to later, is hugely important. And to some extent, reform gives us an opportunity for some of the efficiencies that public service reform requests government deliver.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. You'll know last week we had one of your ministers in committee, the Minister for Further and Higher Education, and the budget that we were talking about last week in that field set out a cut in the resource budget for further and higher education. Last year, these budgets faced in-year cuts, and last week, the Minister could not rule out this happening again for the coming year when asked. So what can the Cabinet Secretary say about whether further in-year cuts may be likely to happen in 2024-25?
So I listened back to my Minister's contribution at your committee over the weekend, and I think you've set out a pretty pragmatic approach in relation to where we are at the current time. As a committee will be aware, when I was appointed back in March, I inherited a teacher's pay deal which required to be funded from my portfolio. So I had to make a number of really tough choices pretty quickly to fund the teacher's pay deal. And the committee will go on, I'm sure, to talk about the detail of some of those budget lines. But in November of this year, the Deputy First Minister published details of where those reductions had come from. And those in-year savings, bluntly, had to be delivered in order to balance my budget, but also in order to pay for a teacher's pay deal that was negotiated prior to my time in post. So those requirements around about the in-year savings have been baked into the settlement for this year's financial allocation. And I recognise the challenge here, and I'm sure we'll come on to talk about that specifically in relation to this budget line. But I do think that, I think to Mr Day's point, you know, the allocations, particularly for colleges, are going to look broadly similar next financial year to those which they have experienced in the last financial year. So there will be challenges in that, I accept that, and we hear today, of course, the inflationary impacts are not going away for any organisation, and I'm keen to work with our colleges particularly on what that will mean for them. But to Mr Day's point around about in-year savings, the challenge that government has faced throughout this year has been the uncertainty of our budget allocations. So I hope that when the Chancellor comes back, of course, for the spring update and spring statement, there may be additionality coming to Scottish Government. Certainly, I would request it came to my portfolio, as the convener would expect. But there is an opportunity, I think, to rebalance here. And we bluntly have been through a period of extreme financial pressure on the Scottish Government budget, which has meant we have had to meet a number of record pay deals across the piece. Those are things that I think were quite right for the Scottish Government to deliver, so the teachers' pay deal being one of them, but it has meant that we have less money overall to go around, and we need to be pragmatic about what that means for every portfolio, including my own.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. You mentioned about the timelines about what you're coming into post. In November 2023, the Deputy First Minister then set out savings of £56 million to the further and higher education budget across demand-led programmes at the Scottish Funding Council. During last week's meeting, the Minister for Higher and Further Education, I indicated that these were to the further education budget, when in fact they affected both further and higher education budgets. So I want to clarify that on record, specifically firstly, but the fact remains, however, that it's really unclear what these demand-led programmes where and where the savings came from. So I was wondering if you could let us know what programmes were affected, because I know that when the Scottish Funding Council were questioned around this £56 million at public audit this week, they were unable to identify specifically these demand-led programmes.
So just for clarity, Convener, are we talking about the Scottish Funding Council cuts or wider?
The £56 million to the Scottish Funding Council that was under the line, I think it was described as a demand-led programmes.
So there are a number of different demand-led programmes. I might bring in Stuart on some of the specifics here. So my understanding was some of the savings that were generated from the Scottish Funding Council included, of course, as the committee will know, the transformation fund that saved in the region of £46 million. So that's been baked into this year's financial settlement. There were a number of other budget-related, demand-led rather, budget lines, which include things, for example, like the education maintenance allowance. We had less uptake of that in the last financial year than had been forecast. We also had reductions to the European Social Fund income, and more broadly, the Strategic Change Transformation Fund too. I don't know, Stuart, if you want to say more on the specifics of those budget lines from last financial year.
So I think it would be hard to add anything over and above what the Chief Executive of the Scottish Funding Council provided to you. The Scottish Funding Council operate a number of programmes that translate the budget settlement into the way the money flows out into both the college and the higher education sector. Some of those programmes will be bid-in programmes that they've set up and funds and so forth. So it's in those areas that they will have seen savings, as you always have within year. And I think the challenge for this budget has been to ensure that those savings have been brought through this year, rather than maintaining the budget at a similar level and then work through savings within year, which I think gets back to your point about the within year savings. What has happened with this budget is to take those tough choices at the start of the year to bake those savings in the 24-25 budget.
So I suppose what I'm asking for some real clarity and detail as to what has, where this 56 million has come from and how it's come about, and if it's possible perhaps to get some more detail and specifics around that. You mentioned a number of programmes, Cabinet Secretary, but it would be good to see what proportion of that 56 million came from each of those to see.
To write to the committee with more detail on that. I don't have the specifics of those budget lines in front of me, but I take your point, convener. I think it would be helpful to set that out to the committee in more detail. Yeah.
Thank you. Can the Cabinet Secretary also say something about how colleges and universities can approach the overall skills reform agenda at a time when they are facing some significant financial pressures? And maybe also dig into about what assistance the Scottish Government and the Scottish Funding Council can help and offer these institutions when we are moving through that period of reform.
So, as I mentioned, I listened to Mr Day's contribution to committee last week, and I think the trajectory in relation to skills reform is in a similar position to that in a school space, which we'll come on to talk to later. I think there are opportunities through reform for efficiencies, and we need to be mindful of that in the current challenging financial context. I know that Mr Day spoke with great passion last week around about the opportunities that colleges saw in that endeavour, and I think that the reform agenda lends itself to us working more closely within our portfolio at the current time. It can often feel quite siloed between responsibilities, and if I may say so to my officials, between directorates even. So there is a need for cross-portfolio collaboration in relation to budget, particularly given the challenge that we all face at the current time. But I'm keen to support Mr Day and his work in leading the skills side of reform. And as the committee will know, and again, we'll go on to talk about this in the next session, I've reformed some of the governance arrangements around about skills reform to bring skills into a space alongside schools so that we can have that cross-portfolio approach to delivering change across the system, but it must be funded. So I spoke to, I think, Michelle Thompson's point earlier on about school reform. There is budget to support that through the school reform programme. We will continue to work with the colleges sector in relation to how we can best support them too in that endeavour.
Okay, thank you. Pam Duncan-Clancy, you're looking to come in.
Yeah, thank you, convener. Just for a brief supplementary, when I'm speaking to colleges, some of the things they're telling me is that in order to make the efficiencies in the reform, they might need some additional funding up front to do that, but there's nothing in the budget. So how do you think the colleges are going to be able to make those efficiencies in the long term without that?
I would agree with the member. There is no additionality in my budget for those that support that might be needed. What I would say to the colleges sector is that I'm keen to work with them very much. So I think I heard that the committee took evidence from Colleges Scotland. Shona Struthers talked about, for example, duplication in the system. This is a point I've discussed with Mr Day at length, given our responsibilities in relation to qualification delivery and the levels of duplication that may exist in the system at the current time. So I think it's important to say that, you know, we have done our best to protect spend across the portfolio, and I'm particularly mindful of colleges and where they are at the current time and their financial sustainability. There is a precarious I suppose, challenge in that sector that has built up over a number of years. And since I've been an MSP, certainly since 2016, there's been industrial action in the sector every single year, I think perhaps bar one. And I think that's detrimental and challenging to trying to change the narrative around about the importance of colleges. And we really need to start celebrating again, I think, the importance of our colleges sector. I'm not going to pretend to the member have additionality to provide other than that which is provided for in the face of the budget. But I do commit to working with the sector on where we can help support them. And that might look like working differently in the future in the space of reform. I heard some suggestions on that from committee members last week, which I think are quite helpful. But I can't pretend to the member that I have additionality to support some of that work because it is not there in my budget. And we're not yet at stage one. So if the member has suggestions from where that could come from in my budget, I'm happy to hear it, or from which other portfolio. But that is a reality that I'm currently working in. And I will not pretend that there is additionality in my budget that doesn't currently exist.
Thanks.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Liam Kerr, sorry, did you want to come in there, Ben? No, you caught my eye, sorry. Liam Kerr, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. The budget proposes a cut of £28.5 million to the teaching grant at universities. Yesterday, the Finance Secretary hesitantly quantified that as about 1,200 first-year student places. Others suggest that it could be over 3,500. Cabinet Secretary, it's your portfolio, so you must have calculated this. How many young Scots will not have a place at Scottish universities going forward?
So I saw some of the coverage from the Finance Secretary's appearance yesterday, and I've seen the press coverage too, and it is the case that these are the additional places that we included in allocations during the pandemic. So it is my understanding, though I'm prepared to be corrected by my officials on this, that, and we have discussed this at length, that these are the additional places we built into the system during the pandemic to protect students and support them through their learning. And remember, during the pandemic, we had higher numbers of young people going on to higher education as a result, largely, and I heard Alistair Sim say this on the radio this morning, of changes to the qualifications and the examinations during the pandemic. So we expected higher numbers to flow into university system, and that's why we built in these additional numbers. What we have done throughout the period since the pandemic is progressively withdraw those places, and this removal is, I think, the final removal of these additional places that were built in prior to my time in office. So that is removing an uplift in funding for over 1,200 places that were added during COVID. I think the member then asked about places for Scots students specifically. And of course, the last official statistics show that in 21-22, we had record numbers of Scottish students starting full-time first degrees at Scottish universities, which I know was welcomed by Universities Scotland. I think there isn't evidence at the current time that we don't have places or enough places for Scottish students at institutions, or that, for example, Scottish students might be choosing to study elsewhere. But it's something I'm keen to keep a very close eye on. But I am mindful that these places, I go back to my initial response, are additional places that were built in during the pandemic. And, you know, the committee understands well enough the challenges all portfolios face. This, to me, in terms of protecting outcomes for our young people, was a decision that I had to take, given the challenges I face elsewhere in the portfolio. And it is additionality we built in during the pandemic.
So you say it is 1,200 places only that are being cut. And you can come back to me on that if I'm not correct. Universities actually, though, say that they need more, not less, funding if they are to reach the 2030 target of widening access. Now, the Scottish Government's own analysis has identified a significant risk that on the current model there will be disadvantages to learners from socio-economically deprived areas. What impact does the Cabinet Secretary predict these swingeing cuts will have on the widening access agenda?
I'm not sure I would characterise funding to universities in those terms. I have seen, I think, evidence from University Scotland, which requested that the funding for these additional places was removed and given to the sector to help respond to some of the points the member makes. And of course, in an ideal world, I would like to be sitting here saying exactly those things. But the reality is I have to balance my budget and I need to identify where savings can be taken. The member asked a question in relation to socio-economic deprived areas, and of course our work on widening access continues. We will work with the sector in relation to progress on that, but I go back to my original point, which is that these were additional places built in during the pandemic. So I'm not necessarily sure to the member's point that I would characterise these removals or the cuts as swinging. They are simply us moving back to where we were prior to the pandemic. The member also asked, I think, a supplementary in his question around about further removal of further places. And of course, at this stage in the budget, we wouldn't be in a position to give the member detailed information on that because, of course, the SFC will need to work with institutions. And it is for ministers to provide the SFC with guidance in relation to any expectations we would have around about courses or places rather that should be protected. So I want to work very closely with the SFC on that very point, to the member's point, around about socioeconomic disadvantage, because we want to protect places for our most disadvantaged young people. That is the point of the widening access policy.
I think many people would characterise a cut of £28.5 million, or 6%, as swingeing. However, we clearly differ on that. Does the Cabinet Secretary get involved in considerations of the economic and future workforce impact of anything between 1,200 and 3,800, say, students leaving Scotland to study elsewhere, both during their education and going forward?
So I'm not sure that we can yet quantify that impact at this stage in the budget process. I'm happy to come back to the member on this in written detail. But at this stage in the budget process, I'm not sure we can yet quantify that impact. And again, I think in my last response, I explained that, of course, we will work with the SFC on these allocations. They go through this process every year. It's a robust process that happens every financial year. It's not something that's new to the portfolio. And we will work with institutions particularly on what that will mean for them. And I think, too, more broadly, that actual impact in relation to the socioeconomic point that the member makes will be quantified in due course, because at this stage in the budget settlement, we don't yet have that clarity or detail from the SFC, because, of course, the SFC need to work with ministers around about the allocation and what that will mean. So I'm not able to give the member more detail at this current time in relation to where we are on the chronology of the budget itself. But I'm happy to write to the member, or to the committee perhaps, convener, with more detail on that point as we progress through the budget process. And again, we're not yet at stage one of the budget. So if the member has suggestions around about where else this finance could be deployed or where else we could meet that requirement or request from the university sector, I'm happy to hear where it may come from.
Well, certainly something that is certain is that funding to Scottish universities for each Scottish student place in the total capped numbers is less than the cost to the university of that place, and 19% less in real terms than in 2013-14, and about 21% less than for English universities. Given that, does the Cabinet Secretary worry that this budget will make Scottish universities ever more dependent on international students? And if so, what plans does she have to address that?
So the member raises a really important point. I engaged directly with university principals. I met with the Edinburgh University principal only last week, discussed this exact issue around about the challenge in relation to international students. And of course, one of the real challenges here, I have to say to the member, are changes made to the immigration rules, which make it far more difficult for universities to attract inward outside students from out with Scotland, and international students actually, because they are put off by the immigration rhetoric coming from the UK government and the rules around about what that might mean for visas. And we heard, of course, more detail on this from Alistair Sim from University of Scotland on GMS only this morning. So I would suggest to the member that some of the challenge here rests with another government. But I do recognise the point he makes in relation to cross-fertilisation of Scottish places. This, of course, is not a new feature in relation to how we fund higher education in Scotland. It has been the case for a number of years. And bluntly, it relates to my party's policy of funding free tuition for our students. I think that's a good policy. It's a policy I will stand by. But it does create challenges for our universities. I recognise that too. Our universities, though, are experts in working independently of government, because they are autonomous, independent institutions to raise finance, whether that be through international students that they may have coming in to study in their institutions or through other sources. So I have a lot of faith in our university sector from my engagement, certainly with principals directly, in their ability to respond to some of the challenges. But I would say to the member that some of the challenge here, particularly in relation to international students, does not rest with the Scottish Government.
But the Cabinet Secretary is suggesting that her government's policies are making the universities ever more dependent upon international students, and then in the same breath saying that decisions taken elsewhere are making that more difficult. So what is she doing to address that, to ensure that Scottish universities are not dependent on the international students?
Well, I say to the member again, the policy of free tuition is one that I will stand by as Cabinet Secretary. It is a policy this government funds. Yes. And of course, we also provide additionality into the sector that doesn't exist in other parts of the UK in relation to student support. I'm sure we might come on to talk about that too. But the current time, of course, the universities are facing challenges in relation to our international students. We've spoken to some of the challenge here in terms of the changes to immigration rules. And that is making it far more difficult for certain institutions to attract inward investment from international students. Some institutions are less dependent, though, I would say to the member, than others. So some universities can weather the storm more so than others. But some institutions in Scotland just now are being harmed by immigration rules, decisions taken by other governments elsewhere. And I say to the member, it's not my responsibility as Cabinet Secretary for Education in Scotland to mop up the mess of a government elsewhere around about its approach to international students and immigration. These decisions have been taken elsewhere, and they are harming the sector in Scotland. And if the member has any leverage with his colleagues in Westminster, then I would suggest that he makes these points to my opponent in Westminster rigorously, because I recognise the challenge here, but I'm not going to walk away from this government's policy of supporting free tuition for our young people.
No, but you'll abandon the university sector.
Interesting choice of words, opponent. It makes it quite confrontational. Can I come back to the 1,200 places for university students that have been removed, shall we say? It's interesting, you know, we're seeing throughout various points of our education system where at the very early years we're seeing fewer young people coming in, but as at other points in terms of 15, 16, 17-year-olds, numbers are increasing. In fact, there is the number of 18-year-olds right now is on an upward trajectory, and it will follow that way for the next 5 to 6 years. So it does seem a bit counterintuitive to me, certainly, that we should be seeking to reduce the number of places for first-year students by 1,200. I was wondering if you had any comments on that, and what sort of data do you use on school age children at various ages to determine your budget and your priorities?
So, I mean, I suppose I go back to the response to Mr Kerr around about these being additional places, but of course we do look to quantify, and the SFC does this measurement in terms of looking at spaces, at places, and how we can allocate additionality into the system and forecasting that and what it will mean for the sector. I should say to the committee, and I'm sure the committee is aware of this, there are longer-term forecasts that look at a reduction in our current school age provision, and therefore across the piece we expect to see less young people coming through the system in the coming years. So that work will be factored into the SFC.
I think that's, I'm agreeing with that, Cabinet Secretary, but I'm saying right now for the next 5 to 6 years we will be seeing an upward trajectory of 17 and 18-year-olds coming in and looking for further and higher education. So I'm addressing the fact that, yes, further down we're going to see reductions, but right now we're going to have a peak in numbers.
I think I go back to the point I made to Mr Kerr around about record numbers of Scottish students going on, Scottish young people rather, going on to university at the current time. So I don't think this removal of spaces is going to adversely affect that. But I go back to the second point I made to Mr Kerr was around about this allocation and work with the SFC, which at this stage in the financial year we wouldn't expect to have detail on at any point in the past. However, I'm more than happy to write to the committee on more detail on that point. These are calculations that the SFC looks at every year. They look at that very point the convener makes around about calculating the number of spaces required, the funding that's required. And then, of course, ministers are required to provide grant provisions. So we will write to the SFC around about our expectations on how we can protect certain courses, how we can protect young people from certain groups, for example. And that is factored into the allocation from the SFC. But you're right to say the SFC look at that as a forward planning approach. These spaces, though, I go back to, are quite unique in that they are additional COVID spaces that we built in during the pandemic. And at a time of financial uncertainty and extreme challenge across my portfolio, the removal, I think, was one of the less worse options, I suppose you could describe it as, in relation to how we might balance the education and skills budget.
I've got some supplementaries in this section here. I've got Ben McPherson, and I'm just double-checking as well. Pam Duncan, has it used? Yes. Okay.
Thanks, Convener. There's been some questions and discussion so far in the session about the potential reduction in numbers in the 24-25 budget. But just for context, I think it's important to consider the provision that there's been in recent years. Cabinet Secretary, you said in 21-22 financial year there was a record number of Scottish students that were state-funded to go to higher education institutions in Scotland. I just wondered if you wanted to put a number on that in terms of, because we're talking tens of thousands of young people having a state-funded opportunity in Scotland that's not available elsewhere in the UK, and indeed it would be useful and interesting, I think, for Parliament to hear the numbers for 22-23 and 23-24.
So I have the UCAS statistics in front of me. I don't know if this is for 22-23, but that shows certainly over 35,000 Scots have once again secured a place at one of our universities. The data from December, last December, shows that we have record numbers of young people going on to at age 19 and under securing a university space in 2023, so last year. That also includes a record number of young people aged 19 and under from deprived areas. So I think, to Mr Kerr's point around about socioeconomic disadvantage, it's hugely important we remember this cohort of young people who are supported through our school system through things like, for example, the Scottish Attainment Challenge, but that we also have that consistency of policy approach to widening access in relation to HE. The member asked a question around about numbers. So since 2006-07, when my party came into office, the number has increased by over 31% to 33,880 in 21-22. So significant numbers of our young people now record, as the member outlines, going on to study full-time degrees at Scottish universities who live in Scotland. And I think that progress is certainly to be welcomed.
And what's the projection for 24-25?
24-25. I do not have that. Mr Gregg, do you have that?
So the figures that are being quoted are from the actual data that's fed back from the universities and so forth, so we don't have the forecast to look ahead.
Do you have an approximate figure? So I've heard 38,000 and between 38,000 and 40,000 quoted in recent days in media sources.
So. Can maybe come back to us with that once you have some.
Yeah, I don't expect that we would have that usually at this time in the year, because of course it must be forecast for next year. So I think we need to have a degree of accuracy here, to the member's point, in relation to media reports. But I can't imagine media reports have the accurate update. I hear figures quoted often in the media that are not necessarily accurate. So once we do have an accurate picture from the SFC around about that provision, happy to again provide that detail to the committee. I would just observe that we are at quite an early stage in the budget process, so some of this will be worked through through the iterations of budget.
Noted, Cabinet Secretary. Pam Duncan Clancy. Sorry, my voice is gone.
Thank you very much, Convener. And maybe I can help the Cabinet Secretary out about the projections for next year, because if the budget of £28 million is to come out of colleges and come out of universities, chances are it will be 3,800 students less next year than it was this year, which I find intolerable, and I hope the Cabinet Secretary also does. The government's own detail on the budget says that changes in the college and HE resource budgets risk reducing education and skills training opportunities for young people and for older people to upskill. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary, how does that meet with the principle of opportunity and equality?
So to the member's first point in relation to places, and we've covered this now with, I think, a number of different members, but the impact on spaces, of course, are these 1,200 spaces that we added in during the pandemic. So the member has now quoted additional figures. I'm not sure the evidence base of that.
So I can help with that. So the 1,200 is the figure you've given for the COVID increase, but the difference is that only saves £5 million. Universities have got £28 million to save. So if you make the comparison, that's an additional 2,600 students less next year. So that means, because of cuts by this government, fewer Scottish students will be able to study at Scottish universities.
So I think the member is misconstruing perhaps some of the data that we have already published in relation to the savings that were taken in year already. So the allocation that universities will receive is broadly similar to that which was received during this financial year.
The best analysis of it is it's only 20 reduction, only. That is a swingeing cut, I would agree. The worst case scenario is it's near 50 million. So actually to claim that it's the same as what they got last year is just inaccurate, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I don't agree with the member's assertion. Of course, the Deputy First Minister published details of those in-year savings that were taken back in November. We've spoken to some of those savings with Convener at the start of the meeting. The member's well versed, for example, in relation to the removal of the Transformation Fund, which was, I think, in the region of £46 million at the start of this financial year. But there are additional savings that had to be taken during the year to balance the budget. More broadly, though, the member is citing specific examples of course reductions that I don't yet have in front of me, because of course during the budgetary process the SFC have to carry out this robust consideration of the number of places that are available. I don't yet have that data in front of me, so these are calculations that have not crossed my desk, but if the member is happy to share her working with me, I'm more than happy to hear it. The SFC, though, have to make these savings in a way that minimises the impact on learning and teaching, and I've been very clear about that. So to the member's supplementary question around about disadvantage, we need to ensure that there is support there for students, particularly from disadvantaged areas. They are doing some of this work around about removing that strategic transformation fund that I spoke to. They've also taken savings from a range of demand-led and other budgets. So some of that has involved underspend. And again, I think I intimated in my response to the convener, I'm happy to share detail of that with the committee, and also through the European Social Fund's income. So those savings that were taken during this financial year are baked into the allocation for next financial year. So a lot of what we're talking about today is not new. It's already in the public domain, and the DFM, of course, spoke to this back in November. But the SFC now has to look at the return of savings, and it needs to provide me with advice around about the allocations going forward. So at the current time, we haven't gone through that robust analysis. That wouldn't happen at this time, usually during the financial year. But what we do know is the 1,200 spaces that the member spoke to, which I have accounted for in responses to the member and to other members, relate to additionality be baked into the system during the pandemic.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Can we come to questions now from Ruth Maguire, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and your officials. I'd like to go back to colleges, if I may. Cabinet Secretary, in opening, you acknowledged that it's not just this year that's financially challenging for the public sector. We've had a decade of challenge, really, and that does impact on organisations' resilience. Our committee's been keen to explore previously how arrangements could be made more flexible for colleges to help them manage challenges. Colleges have had some financial flexibilities around allocation and delivery of credits. At last week's committee meeting, Graeme Day told committee that they hadn't been utilised as expected, that they hadn't made full use of those flexibilities. Can you tell committee a little bit more about what benefits have been seen and any issues that you're aware of in colleges, colleges have faced, in implementing these changes and taking advantage of those flexibilities?
So the arrangements around about colleges' flexibility, I think, were made by Mr. Day and I, my predecessors. So those arrangements were baked in. And I think it's fair to say, as you heard from him last week, some of the changes here haven't been as dramatic as we might have hoped and haven't perhaps delivered the flexibility that we had certainly, or our predecessors and certainly Mr. Day and I, would have hoped for. So the SSC, I know, has made some enhancement in relation to flexibilities on the college funding modes, and they are working with the sector around about the publication of the budget on what the sector can now deliver with the resources it has. But this is not something that's happened overnight. This has been a challenge over the course of a number of years in relation to the power that colleges have in the space of flexibilities. We are working, of course, through the tripartite group, which I know the committee took evidence from Mr. Day on last week, to look at any remaining opportunity that there might be to give colleges that additionality, particularly when ensuring public accountability, because they don't have the same flexibilities that other bodies have in this space. And I recognise that challenge. They've certainly raised it with me directly since my own appointment. But that also includes us looking at processes that allow our colleges to have that maximum flexibility to allow funds to be generated from estate disposals, for example. So I know the committee took evidence on this exact point last week. I think it's fair to say it's not operating in the way that we would have hoped. And part of the challenge here, of course, relates to colleges classification. Stuart might want to say a little bit more on that, because I know this is a historic challenge for colleges. But I think the answer rests in the work of the tripartite group to look again at how we can drive forward more flexibility in this space. I think, as you heard from Mr. Day last week, it's not worked in the way that we would have perhaps first envisaged.
So just to add to those points, the distinction for colleges versus universities, of course, the lack of borrowing powers. So that creates limits to how they can generate funds to invest. And that's why the SFC have put so much time and effort into enhancing the flexibilities available to colleges. I think there was both the evidence last week from Mr Day, and then there was further evidence from the Chief Executive of the Scottish Funding Council last week as well that went into this in quite a level of detail. The only additional point which the Cabinet Secretary mentioned is this point around asset disposal. College sectors sit on a large estate, and the focus of that tripartite group is to find things we can do very quickly together with the SFC and with colleges to give as much flexibility to those colleges right now, so that things like when they sell off some of that estate, those funds can be reinvested swiftly, and some of those funds can be retained by those colleges so that those funds are going into the local investments that are needed. So I think Mr Day is committed to keeping the committee abreast of progress on that.
Thank you. That's helpful to hear. I think particularly the word urgency there will be reassuring to committee. Cabinet Secretary, notwithstanding your previous answers in terms of what assistance can be provided, the SFC highlighted its recent report on colleges' finances to committee, which highlighted that a number of colleges were going to struggle to remain operational. Is the work described there in terms of flexibility the main sort of form of assistance that the government will be able to give and the SFC, or are there other things that can be done to assist?
I think there are other things we will need to consider. I mean, I think I referenced in my response to a member previously my concern around about the colleges sector more generally and the precarious nature of that sector in particular in recent years. And baking in, I think, some of the financial challenge that we have across government makes it even more challenging for the sector. And I'm also conscious of the role that our colleges sector plays for some of our most vulnerable young people. It has a reach that other parts of the education sector doesn't, and we need to be mindful of that in government. I'm actually really keen that through the reform process, we better understand that. And whilst understanding the committee took evidence from Mr Day on this last week, and I will shortly give evidence on school reform, we've got to have a better connect between the two. They feel quite disparate at the current time, which is why I've reformed some of the governance arrangements. Now, you might think that's a tweak. Who cares, Cabinet Secretary? That's not going to deliver real change on the ground. I actually think it's really important. We need to have more of a joined-up approach to how we deliver our education system. And part of the narrative and the rhetoric around curriculum for excellence was meant to be that delivery model. And yet we still seem quite siloed in relation to how we think about the delivery of school education, HE, additionally. I know Mr Day spoke in his appearance last week around about opportunities for reform, particularly for colleges. So this is not just about your point on flexibilities, and the colleges recognise that. That includes, for example, the potential for them to take more of a leading role in the delivery of modern apprenticeships, for example. Now, I heard Mr Day speak to some of this last week. That college's first model would be quite a shift for the sector, I think, in the future. But perhaps there's an opportunity through some of that work on reform to better support the sustainability of the sector. And I suppose it goes back to Ms Duncan Glancy's point around about there's no additionality here. No, there is not, but we will need to look at how we work smarter in the future to help protect that sustainability. And the other point just to make is, of course, there are a number of colleges that are having challenging time at the current time. I know the SFC is working with them directly on that. I think perhaps in the evidence session you heard last week, Mr Day spoke about a number that the SFC have been supporting directly. They do that anyway, without ministers getting involved. But we need to be mindful of the challenge becoming more so, I think, for our colleges sector in the current financial climate. I'm very conscious of that. And I think that reform and the flexibilities we spoke to previously offer us an opportunity and a route forward.
I think, Convener, I particularly recognise that point around the connection between schools and colleges, and certainly in North Ayrshire with Ayrshire College and Irvine Royal, there was previously some excellent programmes. Haven't necessarily continued, and I know that wasn't uniform across the country, but there certainly is good work that can be learned from. If I can just finally ask about staffing. Obviously, staff costs make up more than 70% of college expenditure. And many colleges have run voluntary redundancy schemes. Committee has heard that some are planning compulsory redundancies. Audit Scotland have stated that further staff reductions could, and I'll quote them here, severely erode colleges' ability to deliver a viable curriculum. What is the Scottish Government's response to the FFC's forecast of the potential removal of 21% of full-time equivalent staff employed in the college sector?
So I mentioned, I think, in my response to Ms Duncan Glancy, the real challenge we face here. That's not a challenge that's grown up overnight. This has been happening over the course of time, actually, that Ms Maguire and I have been MSPs, and it actually probably predates 2016 additionally in relation to colleges. We need to be really mindful of the challenge here in relation to industrial action. I remember I was at committee, I think, in September. I remember Mr Rennie asking me a question on this very point in the role of ministers. I am extremely limited in relation to the role that I can play in industrial disputes in the colleges sector because they're independent of government. But I do recognise that the challenge here, and there are ongoing disputes that I'll not comment on. I think at last week's session, Mr Kerr actually raised the Strathesque report with Mr Day around about the recommendations that report made back in 2022. And there is opportunity, I think, through that report to drive forward some of the change we need to see here. We need to reset some of the agenda in relation to colleges and the importance that they play in our education system, because I do worry some of that has been forgotten about in relation to how we think about school education. And the member spoke to some of the opportunity there, particularly in working with our schools. Some of our colleges do fantastic work with our schools. We need to quantify that impact better, and we need to support the sector. I know that we are working on, well, actually, Colleges Scotland have formally responded to the Strathesque report, and they are meeting with trade unions to look at next steps, working with them collectively on supporting the continued success of national bargaining. But I think that does offer us a route forward. But we do need to inject a bit of urgency into this now. I think particularly post-pandemic, you know, the education sector is under an extraordinary amount of pressure post-pandemic. It is expected in all its guises, whether that's early learning and childcare, school, colleges, universities, to mop up all of society's ills and to solve everything. It can't do that alone. And I think we just need to have a bit more of a pragmatic think about how we can quantify the impacts of our education spend on the outcomes for our young people, and our colleges are really fundamental to that drive and resolving some of the ongoing dispute, which I don't want to comment on the specifics on for obvious reasons, will be part of that. And then, as you heard from Mr Day last week, we move forward with these recommendations and try to bring about more sustainability in the sector. Yes, that might look like flexibilities, but it also looks like education reform, giving colleges a driving seat in delivering some of the opportunities that I think reform has for the sector. Thank you. Convener.
Thanks. And Liam Kerr, brief.
Yeah, very briefly, convener, just we all agree on the importance of colleges and the need for support, of no doubt, but the college sector, the further education sector, is still unclear about how much funding that they might have for the coming year, and the finance secretary was unable to answer when they might know yesterday. Does the cabinet secretary have any idea when they will have that clarity? Because obviously they need to make plans for the coming year.
So, I think this goes back to my initial response to Mr Kerr's question around about college places. A lot of this work at this stage in the budget would not yet be known. So the SFC is working at the current time on allocations and translating what that will mean for the colleges sector. So this is not unusual, and it would be, I'd be interested here, probing this issue with officials prior to the committee. I don't think in the past we would ever have had this level of detail at this time in the financial year. So this has always been the case that through the education budget portfolio, we ask the SFC to look at translating that. But I hear the comments from Shona Struthers, and I recognise the challenge there, particularly in relation to the points Ms Maguire was making on financial sustainability and the wider forward look. So I'm happy to write to the committee with more detail when the SFC have decided on and given me advice on those allocations, but we wouldn't expect to have that detail at this point in the financial year.
Do you have a ballpark, Cabinet Secretary, when they might?
Well, we're not yet at stage one in the budget. I will defer actually to one of my officials, but we do anticipate those allocations being very similar to the core funding that colleges received and are investing in 23-24, which I think was the point I made to Ms Duncan Glancy previously. So, but in simpler terms, the funds available to colleges at the start of 24-25 are expected to be very, very similar to those this financial year. But I'll pass to Mr Gregg in relation to a specific date on which we can provide the committee the specifics he asked for.
So the letters of guidance to the Scottish Funding Council, they typically be issued in March. I don't see any reason why that isn't the target date this year. So it's the work between now and through that early stage of February is where that really intense work takes place with SFC. So that should give you the timeline.
So can we come now to questions from Ross Greer, please? Thanks for your patience, Ross.
Thanks, Convener. Not a problem at all. Morning, Cabinet Secretary. The budget line for student support and tuition fees payment is down 23.4 million compared to what was allocated in the previous year's budget. The detail for that, the explainer for that, is a combination of recognising the in-year savings that took place. So the allocation for next year is going to more closely reflect the actual spending in this current financial year, but also some presumptions around anticipated demand. I was wondering if you could detail a little bit exactly where within that budget line that the savings are coming from, particularly in relation to what effect that might have on student support.
So in relation to student support, we do have a generous offer in relation to student support. Some of the budget lines the member spoke to were published by the DFM back in November, and they were taken as in-year savings, and the member's right to say those were excuse me, Convener, they were demand-led budgets, so there were a number of savings quantified by baked-in presumptions around about uptake that bluntly just wasn't there. So there were savings that we were able to identify through that process. In terms of the support for student support, we have built into the budget an increase in relation to higher education student support by £2,400 for all undergraduate students. That's an equivalent uplift that will be applied to the postgraduate support package in the same year. So that's raising student support for those who might be disadvantaged, so care leavers, for example, Australian students, and those from the socioeconomic areas that Mr Kerr spoke to earlier on. But we will have to, I think, consider more broadly student support in the round. It is worthwhile saying, though, the support and tuition fees are demand-led. And so during 23-24, we had £21.6 million of savings identified due to reduced demand. So those savings are baked into this year's financial allocation because the demand, they're both demand-led budgets, and therefore the demand simply wasn't there last year.
So in that case, this is almost entirely a reflection of the in-year saving from this year. There's a marginal additional amount then. Mm-hmm. Can I just clarify then where those demand-led changes came from? I recognise what you said, DFM published this in November. Mm. Apologies, I can't remember the detail of everything from that point. So if you could just give us a little bit more detail on how much of that came from demand around student support programmes versus tuition fee payment.
I, from memory, it's a mixture. I may bring in Stuart on the specifics of that, but it's not a clear-cut split, if that's the point of the question.
In response to my questions earlier on that demand-led, I think you were expecting some more information
right.
to come.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm not asking you to respond a second time to that question. That's OK.
You're right,
Secretary.
Convener. We'll cover that then in the update to the committee.
Okay. Convener, I'll come back in on the
thank
subsequent.
Thank you very much. Can we come to questions now from Bill Kidd, please?
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, CabSec and team. Now, you've already spoken to us about the necessity of moving money from one area to another because of the tightness of the budget in certain levels. but the budget has set a cut, we're told, of £23.5 million for the overall lifelong learning and skills budget. £13.7 million of this coming from the skills budget line, including cuts to grant funding for supporting young people into employment, education and training. Now, this is obviously an area which the Scottish Government has been very, very happy to push on developing the skills abilities of people who are not in universities, but maybe using colleges for boosting their skills training and so on. Now, in terms of these cuts, what impact do you believe this will have in achieving the ambitions of the skills system reform?
So I think, to Mr Kidd's question, convener, this is in a similar space to the question from Mr Greer around about savings that were taken during this financial year and the detail in relation to those specific programmes. So I can include that in the written update to committee if that helps. The member quoted £23.5 million. I have the savings in front of me. I'm not sure where he gets that number from. If it's from the lifelong learning and skills budget line, I suspect that's where it's from, perhaps with an addition elsewhere. Yeah. But if the member is able to clarify, perhaps after committee, I'm more than happy to include that detail in the written update that will cover the convener's points and Mr Greer's points additionally.
Well, I understand that. OK, thank you very much. Thank you.
OK, thank you. Moving on now to Willie Rennie.
So I've got a question about the whole family wellbeing fund. The commitment is £500 million over the course of this parliament. So far, £100 million has been committed. That will mean £400 million in the last year of the parliament. How on earth are you going to do that?
So before I answer this question, I'm going to give a very factual answer, convener. My wife sits as a member of the board, the Promise Oversight Board, and I have an interest here. So given that, he will understand my factual response. And then I will pass to Andrew to answer his substantive question. So we have allocated £50 million from the Whole Family Wellbeing Programme for 24-25. That, I think, is significant investment in relation to how we go about keeping the promise. And it is working to support local areas to really transform some of their services. The Deputy First Minister actually has lead responsibility for the Whole Family Wellbeing Fund. And in terms of the policy, I will now defer to Andrew Watson, noting my interest.
Thanks. Probably just a couple of points to make on your question. So, firstly, you're right, the commitment is still the government's commitment on £500 million of investment in whole family wellbeing. I think the next key stage for us will be the publication this year of an investment strategy, which sets us in with a more detail about our forward plans for the funding. And one of the things that obviously that can do is look at evaluation of the funding so far. So we're due to publish, I think, later this month or early into February, a significant evaluation of how the fund has been performing so far. That will then inform the strategy the DFM will publish later in the year. I think in terms of decisions about remaining funding over the Parliament, clearly that's for annual budget cycles. We haven't set out a multi-year budget for that, so the decisions about levels of funding beyond 24-25 would clearly be part of the budget process in future.
So, I won't be too political with you, but could you realistically spend £400 million in 1 year in order to meet the promise?
So I guess a couple of points on that. One is thinking about the purpose of the spend. So at the moment, a lot of the funding is being routed through community children's services planning partnerships. So there's been a particular way of using the funding at the moment, and the evaluation will tell us how effective that has been. So one of the answers to your question, I guess, is in the future, would the funding be used in different ways, and that might then affect the ability to spend it within the time period. I think the second point to consider, and the DFM will be considering, is the feedback from delivery partners. So I think you're possibly implying that there is discussion with partners around their ability to spend quickly in local areas, and we need to take that into account in terms of the future plans. So I think it's fair to say spending a large amount of money over a short period of time can be challenging, but I think the answer to the question really lies in who's spending the money and on what purpose. I suppose a final point would be one of the rationales behind Whole Family Wellbeing Funding is it's around holistic support for families. So there's actually quite strong connections between the Whole Family Wellbeing Funding and other investments the government's making. So, for example, investment in school-aged childcare. So one of the other things we need to do with the investment approach is look at the range of different funding streams that all have an impact on the same families, the same communities. So it might be quite a strategic approach we take around those issues. So
convener, I just want to note, and I don't expect an answer to this, that Nicola Sturgeon, the former First Minister, asked the current First Minister this last week and didn't really get an answer. And we've not really had an answer today. I hope maybe the Cabinet Secretary could ask the Deputy First Minister to respond whether the money will be committed in full.
by the end of the Parliament.
I'm happy to ask the DFM to respond. She has lead responsibility, but that is the public commitment at the current time. And she's leading, I know, on the feedback in relation to the timescales to the members' point. So we will take that away as an action from today's committee.
Thank you. Right, early learning and childcare. So I've seen the £12 an hour. I've had the promise that there would be more coming in addition to that to close the gap between the PVI sector, private, voluntary, independent sector, and the council pay rates that's resulting, as you know, in the departure of experienced staff from private nurseries. And so I was promised that we would have a solution, but I've not seen anything. What's happening?
So I think the £12 an hour...
It doesn't, and I've had an acknowledgement from your minister that it doesn't deal with the problem that we've talked about, which is the loss of experienced staff who will be above the £12 an hour. So this doesn't help that. How are you going to close the gap?
Well, I think the sustainable rates review gives us an opportunity to do that. But bluntly, we need the PVI sector to operate in relation to how we deliver our childcare expansion. So we need them to be operational. The member and I have talked about this previously. I think the £12 an hour commitment is actually really important. It does, the draft budget, provide local authorities with an additional £16 million, and that is to pay for staff in the PVI sector, who will be delivering funded ELC from April of this year. So I think that really demonstrates our commitment to the Fair Work agenda, but it also, to the member's point, demonstrates our commitment to recognising the challenges in the PVI sector, and we've discussed this previously. The member might not think it's enough, the sector might not think it's enough. Okay, I would like to hear from where in my budget the additionality should come from.
No. This is your promise, your issue that you promised to resolve. It's not my issue, it's your issue. So don't put it back on me. I've got various nurseries that have come to me and said they've advertised posts for £12 an hour. Their local council are advertising exactly the same post for £16 an hour. How are they supposed to close that gap? They're a charity. Where do they find the £4 an hour from? They are in serious problems if you cannot provide the funding that's more equivalent to the council nursery funding.
So, look, I accept the premise of the member's question. The point I was making to him is I am dealing with an extraordinarily challenging budget settlement. All cabinet secretaries are. Taken as a result of an unfair allocation, I think, from the UK government. We can have a debate about that another day. But let's look at what I have in relation to my portfolio. And I actually think the £12 an hour additionality that has flowed to my portfolio as a result of this commitment is to be welcomed. I recognise that some local authorities might be paying more than that, but there has been significant investment from the First Minister, actually, into this specific commitment. And I think it does help to bridge the gap between the PVI sector and the local authority-run sector. It also means an increase of around about £2,000 a year for eligible staff who are working full-time. So I think that's to be welcomed. I recognise there will remain to be challenges here. The Sustainable Rates Review gives us an opportunity, I think, to reset some of that. We need to work with the PVI sector, though, on the delivery of what this will look like. And I've heard some of the critique around this. I hear it from Mr. Rennie today. But the reality is there is no additionality in my budget to meet additionality in terms of that ask. So if we need to look again at that offer, it will need to come from somewhere. And if not from my budget, then again, we're going into a round of budget negotiations in the Chamber. There will be opportunities for opposition parties to put forward suggestions. I hear the member's point around about it's my problem as Cabinet Secretary. I accept it. But actually, we have taken direct action in this budget around about supporting the PVI sector, action that hadn't been taken previously. So I hope the member recognises that.
So you may be in trouble with your First Minister, because the First Minister, during the SNP election hustings, promised to resolve this problem. So I would suggest
he promised completely.
I heard it. He promised he was going to close the gap between the council and the private nurseries. And I've heard nothing today to indicate that you've solved the problem that he said he had identified and would commit to solving.
But there is additionality in the budget of £16 million to increase pay in the PVI sector to £12 an hour. Well, I don't agree with the member.
Well,
the First Minister committed to this additionality. It is in my budget, so there has been direct action taken. Now, the member may not think it's enough. That's a separate issue. there has been action taken in relation to closing that gap between the PVI sector and the local authority sector. But look, we'll have to continue to work with local government around about some of the challenge here, because it's not something that's going away. But this additionality, I think, will make things better, and it will mean, of course, an extra £2,000 a year for staff who are eligible. And I would have thought that Mr Rennie might have welcomed
nurseries will hear what you're saying, and they will not be impressed, because they've been waiting a long time for this. But let's move on. One final question. National Gaelic Plan, how are we going to make sure that it's adequately funded to meet the commitments that you've made?
So in relation to Gaelic, of course, we're taking forward legislation through the bill that we've presented later this year. And of course, in relation to the work around about Gaelic, we'll continue to work with Borna Gaelic and others in terms of their obligations around about a National Gaelic Plan. The legislation itself actually gives Gaelic and Scots language official status, and it also looks to change some of the way in which we support the Gaelic language and Scots languages in schools, including changes to education. So we will look to support, of course, the development of that. It's worthwhile saying that support for Gaelic has increased from over £50 million back in 2005-06 to around £25 million in the current budget allocation. The way in which we fund Gaelic is split between our approach to education and also those for the cultural side of things, I suppose you would classify it as. So MGALPA sits in my budget line too, and we support Gaelic broadcasting through that additionally.
Okay, thank you very much. Pam Duncan-Clancy, can we come to yourself now, please?
Thank you, Convener. I'm not sure if I said good morning earlier, so good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you for your contributions so far. The Cabinet Secretary will be well aware of the importance that I place on non-contact time for teachers. And so I wonder if she can set out how the 24-25 budget will support the aim to reduce non-contact time for teachers.
So the member raises a very important point. I'm sure we will be discussing it at length in the chamber later this afternoon. So I think part of the challenge around about whether it's behaviour, whether it's attendance, whether it's curriculum, whether it's reform, is actually around about teachers' conditions and their place of work. And if I can just reflect on last year and the negotiations around about the pay settlement, that didn't look at changing conditions or improving conditions for teachers. And I think we have an opportunity through the commitment to reduce class contact to do just that. We commissioned independent research that I wrote to the member about at the end of last year, which is looking at this exact issue, because of course class contact across the country looks different for every teacher. It won't be the same, despite the allowances that are built in for all teachers in relation to Macron and their non-class contact time. So we are looking at the picture nationally to get that granular picture of the current allocation. Convener and I spoke earlier on around about the falling pupil role, and that will have, I think, an impact on what we're able to deliver. We need to be mindful of that too, in terms of the forecast and the financial challenge within the budget. However, I'm very much committed to looking at how we can deliver this. The challenge also that I face in this space, I should say, is that it depends on negotiation between the SNCT. So that tripartite approach, which is, of course, the approach that was adopted by Macron when I think Jack McConnell established the approach there back when I was at school some years ago now, means that we need to work on that tripartite basis to enable any reduction in class contact time across the country nationally. But look, I accept the challenge here, but there's also an opportunity to get this right for Scotland's teachers. And if I could just reflect on the last 8 or 9 months in post, that to me is part of the jigsaw that hasn't yet been tackled. That's actually how we can go about responding to some of the challenges in our classrooms, whether that's on attendance, behaviour, and actually on curriculum reform too. We need to build in time for teachers. It's one of the reasons I decided to delay legislating last year, actually, because I didn't feel that secondary teachers in particular had been given that time. We need to give them that time to allow them to... we can have debate with the trade unions, I'm sure we will, around about the purpose of that time, but we need to build that into, I think, how we support a profession of teachers in the 21st century, and we're not yet there. So the work is ongoing. I don't yet have the commissioned response. It is coming to me. I'm looking to Mr. Anson to my right, because his team has been leading on the commissioning of this work. We expect, I think, to have that by the end of this month.
We expect that to report in January.
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you. And on much of what the Cabinet Secretary has just said about the importance of non-contact time, including on behaviour in schools, teacher terms and conditions, we'll find agreement. But I heard nothing about what's in the budget this year to deliver it this year. So can I assume the Cabinet Secretary doesn't expect the promised reduced non-contact time to be delivered this year?
No, I think we will make progress this year in relation to the commitment. But what I would say to the member is delivering a reduction in relation to class contact time would not be something that would happen overnight. It would take that approach from the SNCT, which they have not been able actually to resolve over the course of years. This has been ongoing since, I think, the last election, that negotiation. So there have been challenges here for some time. But we will work with the SNCT on the delivery of that commitment. I don't yet have the evidence base, though, to give the member a full answer. So, again, I'm happy to include that in the written update to committee, because I expect that evidence base to give me numbers around about what any additional budget might be in relation to the delivery of that commitment.
OK, thank you. And I appreciate that, Cabinet Secretary, but the commitment was made in the manifesto for the SNP government, current government, in 2021. It has already been years, so teachers are looking and waiting. I'll move on, if that's all right, to breakfast provision and free school meals. There doesn't appear to be anything in the budget for the provision of breakfasts in every primary school and special school, which, of course, was another one of the government's commitments. Does the Cabinet Secretary expect to deliver free breakfasts in all primary schools and special schools in this coming year?
Well, we're still working towards that commitment, and what I would say to the member is free breakfasts are actually available in a number of schools across the country just now, because head teachers are choosing to use their PEF funding, that additionality that the government provides, to invest in free breakfasts. So there are hundreds of schools across Scotland just now that are already delivering free breakfasts. And what I've asked officials to do is to give me granular evidence in relation to that audit of what's happening at the current time. We have a mixed approach to breakfast provision. Some local authorities, I should also say, take political choices to invest in funding breakfast provision. Now, that's a choice for local authorities to take. You might argue I should provide that additionality into the system. There is a tension here, I think, in relation to local authorities' responsibilities sometimes, but it is a commitment we are working towards delivering. I recognise a lot of schools are currently already delivering free breakfast, so I need to, first of all, have the national picture in relation to what that looks like.
With respect, Cabinet Secretary, that is not a statutory requirement and funded by the government, which is what the manifesto said. That's goodwill of some schools using PEF funding, which incidentally is stretched to its limit already, rather than the government funding a pledge that they'd made in their manifesto?
Well, with respect to the member, the allocation that I have for my portfolio is extremely challenging, which is why I have had to take tough decisions through this financial settlement. The member has heard some of them. We will rehearse them, I'm sure, again.
It was your commitment, Cabinet Secretary.
Sorry?
It was your government's commitment.
I understand it was my government's commitment. I asked the member where I should find that additionality from my budget. I also say to the member, I don't yet know what the national picture is currently in relation to the provision of free breakfast, because, of course, some local authorities are taking that decision to deliver free breakfast anyway. Some local authorities, I should also say to the member, took a decision to wipe school meal debt. Others have not done that. So what the government have done in this budget is provide an additional £1.5 million to some local authorities who have not been able to wipe school meal debt to encourage good behaviour. So I say in relation to free school breakfast that there is funding provided through PEF, for example, for local authorities to take political decisions at local level to provide that additionality. Some have done that. I praise those local authorities for promoting and supporting the nutrition of our young people in our schools. Others have taken decisions to invest funding elsewhere. I want to know what the national picture is. That's why I've asked for this audit in relation to breakfast provision.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And I think head teachers in schools across the country will be looking and asking the question, how many times do you want me to spend my PEF, if that's the answer on breakfasts. I'm going to move on to my final question.
Can I interject us slightly? Because I do have Ross Greer wanting to come in on the theme of breakfast, if that's OK, before we move on. Thank you.
On school meal debt.
Yes, thank you very much, Ross.
Just briefly on that, Cabinet Secretary, and apologies to Pam for jumping in on this. Cabinet Secretary, could you just clarify what you were saying there? The local authorities that have already wiped out their school meal debt, they won't be entitled to access this new fund that's been announced. This is purely for the local authorities who have not yet taken that action. Is that correct?
Yes, I think that's my understanding, certainly, of the way in which we will administer the fund.
And is this a fund that the local authorities will have to proactively apply for and evidence the level of debt they've got? The reason that I'm asking that is when I started doing the FOI research on this, it became clear that some larger local authorities in particular were actually masking the level of school meal debt. They were only confirming the debt data they had held centrally, and they actually weren't bothering to ask all their schools. And I think in some cases, the actual level of school meal debt is larger than what the local authorities have been telling all of us. But I'm not sure if you have different information.
So I can't give Mr Greer a specific answer in relation to local authorities masking their school meal debt. I don't think that would be wise, but I take the point he makes, and there have been some suggestions around about, I think from Aberlour and others, and I think Mr Greer has done some work on this very issue in relation to school meal debt previously. The way in which we'll administer the fund is it will be for local authorities to apply, but they will also have to provide us with that evidence base in relation to the debt, so we will be looking at the granularity in any claims around about school meal debt. But I say to Mr Greer, as I think I said to Ms Duncan Glancy, in a similar space on breakfast, local authorities already have the power to wipe school meal debt. Many of them have done that. And again, I praise them for that action.
And just very briefly, finally, on that, COSLA have produced excellent advice and guidance for how schools should manage their meal debt. Will local authorities who have not adopted it, and I think there's quite high overlap between those who have not written off school meal debt and those who have not adopted the COSLA guidance, will they be encouraged or even required to do so by the government to access the money that you're making available?
That I do not know the answer to, Mr Greer. I will defer to Mr Anson on that point, but I think that would be our expectation.
It's absolutely our expectation for they will adhere to that guidance going forward, yes.
Excellent, thank you. Thanks, Convener.
To you now, Pam Duncan Clancy. Thank you for allowing that interjection.
No problem at all, Convener. And when we were discussing breakfast and free school meal there, I was mindful that my colleague had a question on it. So that's fine. So the next question I have is around teachers in schools. And I think it's fair to say that as well as head teachers looking in, asking how many times to spend PEF, I think local authorities are now going to be looking in, also asking how many times to spend their budget, because it is significantly tight. In an answer to me on teacher numbers, Cabinet Secretary said that providing the ratio stayed, if it rose above 13.7%, the ratio of teachers in the national average, she would indeed look to claw back some funding from local authorities. The national average of the national ratio is currently 13.2%, but local authorities have already said that they are fearful that they'll have to give some money back, and 15 local authorities haven't met their targets. So can the Cabinet Secretary clarify the position on this and set out in clear terms whether she expects any local authorities to have to return funds allocated for this purpose?
Very happy to do so. So I think Ms Duncan Glancy is talking, when she talked about 13.7% about pupil-teacher ratio. So we have the lowest pupil-teacher ratio in Scotland in the whole of the UK, which is certainly welcome. That means we have the most teachers per pupil in the whole of the UK too. The point I think Ms Duncan Glancy is asking about is this £145.5 million additionality that we baked into the settlement with local government that was meant to be for additional teachers in the system. And it's fair to say that some local authorities have used that for protecting teacher numbers. And again, I praise those local authorities, and particularly heads of education and leaders of councils, who have said we will use this ring fencing to protect teachers in our schools, because we know that actually teachers make a difference. That's how you improve outcomes for our young people. You can't close a poverty-related attainment gap with less teachers in our schools. But there are some local authorities who have taken other decisions. And for a number of different reasons. Now, some in the, I think, 15 or so that she quoted have maybe gone down by one or two. So I think we probably need to not consider them in the round. I think there are maybe four or five from memory where there has been a significant fall. And I have asked for an explanation from all of those local authorities as to why that may be the case. I have not yet made a decision on this challenge, but I do retain the right to recoup some of the funding. It's worthwhile saying the way in which we administer the £145 million from memory, Sam will correct me if I'm wrong, is we hold back some of that funding for the very purpose that if a local authority doesn't meet the requirements of ring fencing this funding for teacher numbers, we will not pay it out. So I retain the power to do that and to hold on to that additional funding.
I appreciate that. But in the answer to me, you said that whilst the national ratio remains below 13.7%, you would not claw back funding. It's 13.2%. So will local authorities have to give the money back or not?
Well, we are, I think, in answer to Ms Duncan Glancy's question, I said I would look at every local authority and its merits in detail. So
not the national ratio then, which is what you said in your answer.
Well, the national ratio, I maybe defer to Sam on this in relation to the pupil-teacher ratio, but actually I'm also concerned by government having provided an additional £145 million and some councils choosing not to use that to protect teacher numbers. So actually, I mean, the argument around about PTR is part of it, But it's not the whole answer here. Mm-hmm. If that additionality that central government has given local councils to pay for teachers hasn't mm-hmm. been used for teachers, then the question has to be, what has it been used for?
And I don't disagree that it's not the whole answer, but it is the answer you gave me.
I defer to Sam in relation to PTR and the role it plays in terms of our calculation. It might be that that's something that we factor in. I think there's a... In my correspondence with local authorities, I've asked for any extenuating circumstances they might have that explain it. So for some, there might be a rationale. I have heard some responses from local authorities which account for some of the change. And we need to be mindful of that. But there have been some other movement. There has been some other reduction, I should say, in the system, which I don't find acceptable, particularly when, at a time of extreme financial pressure, we're providing this additionality and protecting it. We would expect to see teacher numbers protected from all locals.
Sam Anson.
Yeah. Thank you. So I think the process with the local authorities has been quite clear throughout. In February 2023, we wrote to local authorities with a set of criteria for the £145 million. The primary point of those criteria was that at a national level, teacher numbers should remain constant. Yeah. Now, we saw in the recent census in December, they fell ever so slightly. And so therefore, for those local authorities, and you're quite right, there was 15 where the teacher numbers had reduced. We asked for an explanation as to why those teacher numbers had reduced. We're working through those responses at present. They're quite complex. There's a variety of reasons, and we're just trying to assess the extent to which some of those are justified and others where we feel they're less justified.
Yeah.
And my final question on this, with the convener's permission, thank you. If that is the case and you're looking at the reasons that the numbers fell, are you also looking at what the local authorities might have had to use some of that money that they had for in relation to education, for example, free breakfasts or writing off school meal debt or meeting the needs of pupils with additional support needs, given that this budget only increases that resource by 600,000? So are you looking at how else they might have had to spend that money?
We're looking in detail at all the 15 responses, and we've asked local authorities to present to us proactively the reasons why they feel they've not been able to use the £145 million for the express purposes of maintaining teacher numbers.
I appreciate that, and that might, I suspect, speak to some recruitment issues. It might speak to some geographical issues. There's a whole host of reasons I expect you'll get back in that, and that would be interesting. But are you also asking, if the money was given to local authorities to do that and they didn't do it, did they deploy it to the education budget and address some of the other challenges which we've discussed already this morning?
Well, we would expect to see details of any of that additionality in their returns. And okay. I think the committee took evidence from this last year on this point from someone who shall remain nameless, who talks about, you know, the role of teachers and then other professionals in education also being important. I don't think you can replace a teacher in a classroom with people who are not trained teachers. So we need to be a bit mindful of this. This additionality was agreed to in an arrangement between government and COSLA that it would be protected for teacher numbers. That is what our local authorities signed up to deliver. They understood the rationale behind it. They understood the requirements around about this funding. That's why we hold back some of the funding at a certain point in the financial year. It gives me the opportunity to hold it back. I think maybe some local authorities didn't think we would do that because it didn't happen last year, but I retain the power to do so, and we will look in detail at, I think, the four or five where we have seen the significant falls. In some of the local authorities, Ms Duncan Glancy quoted from memory, we're talking maybe one or two. So I think in those instances, we should look at them, but it's where we've seen greater falls. And look, Ms Duncan Glancy makes a point around about other areas that it might have been spent on. I'm happy to hear that rationale. We set that out in the requirements and we will look at it in detail, recognising that for all local authorities, this has been a challenging time, just as it has been for government.
Thank you.
Thank you. And I think it's my recollection of some of that evidence that it was speaking about the complementary nature of having teachers and PSAs and speech language therapists in the classroom. So it wasn't perhaps as
one or the other.
Binary as the other. So can I now move to some questions from Bill Kidd, please. Thank you.
Thanks very much, convener. Cabinet Secretary and your officials have already covered a great deal to do with local authority dealings after the budget and so on. But what specific discussions have you had with local authority representatives on how the budget settlement will actually support delivery and improvement of education and children's services? You know, not the difficulties that you've had, but how it will actually make an improvement for children's learning.
So I thank Mr Kidd for his question. I think he raises an important point. Look, we have a new deal with local government through Verity House arrangements, and some of the budget settlement, as the committee will be aware, looks to remove a level of ring fencing. I think there are two budget lines from which we take ring fencing away from that are already baselined into their grant, as it were, for local government, and so will be contained within that but come from my budget. Then there are additional lines that come from me directly that are more ring-fenced, although they're quite a small proportion, I think 5% or something overall, around about, that we ring-fence. So they have flexibility to some extent in relation to how they spend other than that 5%. What I was keen to do through Verity House was to establish a quality assurance framework between ourselves and local authorities. That's something we've been working on since the summer. So in August, we began engagements with COSLA. I meet with COSLA every 2 or 3 weeks, very, very regularly. And I'm very keen that we deliver on a change in relation to that relationship. So yes, through Verity House, but also through accountability. So you might argue, well, I might argue, I'm hyper-accountable as Cabinet Secretary to you in committee, to Chamber, to the media. And yet, education is actually delivered by local authorities and they retain statutory responsibility of that. And when we look at some of the exam performance in last year's exam results, as I do, there is variability in the system. And we need to tackle variability in terms of outcomes. That's how you close the poverty-related attainment gap. We need to drill into some of that. Now, Education Scotland, we have a team there of attainment advisors that the committee will probably be familiar with, who are supporting every single local authority in relation to trying to close the gap. Part of that work has been driven by local authorities identifying their stretch aims, which essentially is them forward planning and saying by in 3 years' time, this is the progress we will have made on closing the gap. And Education Scotland are involved in challenging local authorities and supporting them additionally. But that, I think, speaks to Mr Bill's question around about improvement and delivery. We need to get into a better space that recognises that local authorities have responsibility here. And in terms of improvement, you know, whether it's on behaviour, on attendance, on curriculum, local authorities have a real responsibility here. Some of them take that extremely seriously and they have really good support mechanisms in place with quality improvement officers, for example. I want to look and work with actually local authorities in supporting them to deliver that. Part of improvement, of course, is also supported by the appointment of the new chief inspector. Again, I don't want to jump ahead, convener, but of course, we're going to go on to talk about reform in the next session. And I think the new chief inspector has a key role to play in supporting local authorities in relation to improvement. And of course, the new chief inspector, I should say interim chief inspector, has powers as well to invest carry out their own investigations, their own inspections, rather, of local authority improvement mechanisms and how they work to support schools. And I know there are some in the system that say that that is a starting point for the new chief inspector. I'm sure she has her hands full at the current time in relation to a few other things I've sent her way, but I do think we should look at how central government supports the improvement function at local authority level, because there are 32 different approaches to it across the country. And look, sometimes that difference is a strength of the Scottish system in relation to education, but sometimes we're not great at learning from others where there are pockets of good practice. That's where Education Scotland and the attainment advisors have a key role to play.
Okay, thank you very much for that. Can I just ask finally from me, do you believe that this direction that has been headed in it shows genuine and measurable signs that things are improving in terms of delivery of educational services?
Tentatively, yes, but we need to work together more closely. And in the past, government and local government can sometimes have our challenges, I think it's fair to say. I've just rehearsed some of those with Ms Duncan Glancy around about teacher numbers. But in my experience of dealing with COSLA, they have a pragmatic approach to the delivery of education at local authority level. They want to be transparent about what that means for outcomes for our young people. They want to support where they can, improving outcomes for our young people. And look, that's my job as Cabinet Secretary, giving them the opportunity to deliver on those improvements to help our young people to succeed. So I think we have reset some of the relationship there with local government. I'm not necessarily sure I can give you a scorecard at the end of this year. Maybe come back to me next year, Mr Kidd, and I'll give them a mark out of 10 and see how we've done on improving that relationship. But particularly, it's not just on having improved relationships. It's on working better to improve outcomes. That's why the accountability framework that we're working on with them, particularly in relation to school education and that variability across the system, is hugely important.
Thank you very much indeed for that. Thank you.
And then finally, I suppose, Cabinet Secretary, you've spoken there about resetting your relationship with working with local authorities. I'd be interested in what scorecard you might give the City of Edinburgh Council that is looking to deliver £8.2 million worth of cuts to the devolved school management fund, if you're aware of that.
So I'm not cited on the specifics of Edinburgh Council. I think the committee took evidence from Peter Bain at School Leaders Scotland on this, and SLS have certainly raised devolved school management challenge with me previously. I'll take a look at the specifics in relation to Edinburgh City Council, and I know that the convener and I are having a meeting on a separate issue, so in that meeting we could perhaps update you on any engagement officials have had with Edinburgh Council. I'm not cited on the specifics myself.
Front page of the evening news today.
Not my local paper, I should say.
And I've got Michelle Thompson very briefly before we finish up this session. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Convener. I was just checking some of the earlier discussions about student numbers with the UCAS clearing table, and it shows that there were 20, this is of Scottish domiciled students, that 2019 shows 28,750 Scottish domiciled students, and if we, setting aside a range of other factors, which we all understand, if there was a reduction from the 2023 figure, which was 30,050 of 1,200, that would take us back to 28,850, which compares very favourably with the 28,750 in 2019. Mm-hmm. I thought that would be helpful to put that on the record, Cabinet Secretary. Do you have anything to add to that? Am I correct?
No, I think that is helpful, and it is correct to recognise that we are going back to the situation which existed prior to the pandemic, and we just should be mindful that the education system has been through a period of turmoil in relation to COVID. That additionality was built into the system much in the same way that we have now gone back to using examinations in schools post-pandemic. Things are different. And when we try to baseline or measure things against the year that came prior to, when there were additional place in the system, I don't think that gives an accurate depiction. Much like when we try to compare the attainment gap to that which existed last year or the year prior to, because we had different arrangements in place for those years. So I think the member is absolutely accurate and correct in her assessment there to compare those numbers with 2019. It gives a better overall understanding of the progress that we're making in relation to student places.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, and well done, Michelle Thompson, on getting that on record. Can we now conclude the first part of our evidence session, and we'll suspend until 11:10. No, 11:12, sorry, I can't add 30. Yes, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Welcome back. We are continuing to take evidence from the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills this morning, and we are now going to move to questions around the education reform agenda. And alongside the Cabinet Secretary for the second session are officials Claire Hicks, who's the Director for Education Reform, and Laura Murdoch, the Deputy Director, Curriculum and Qualifications Division, Scottish Government. Good morning. And I now like to invite the Cabinet Secretary to make some brief opening remarks on the education reform agenda before we move to questions from members. Again, Cabinet Secretary, you've up to 3 minutes.
Convener, I'm pleased to be back at committee to update on progress on education reform. I provided updates to Parliament back in November and in December of last year, and the Minister for Higher and Further Education appeared before your committee last week. The International Council of Education Advisors report back in November recommended that we do not change structures too much in the short to medium term and focus on improving teaching professionals and their development, collaboration and innovation. This is at the forefront of my thinking, and we cannot unleash the potential that reform has without taking the teaching profession with us. The Education Bill consultation closed just before Christmas, seeking views on proposals for the new qualifications body and the approach to inspection. A series of events heard the views of nearly 1,000 teachers and many others working in education, and my thanks go to all of them. We will continue to engage, including critically, with the voices of children and young people throughout the reform process. The role of leadership in the national bodies will be crucial in transforming practice and culture. I appointed the new SQA chair in November, Shirley Rogers, the first woman to hold this post, and approved the appointment of an interim Chief Inspector of Education, Jenny McManus. I also announced my intention to initiate a curriculum improvement cycle from this year. That will include curriculum content, the role of knowledge, transitions between primary and secondary, and alignment between the broad general education and senior phase. And my view is that maths education should be the initial focus for improvement. We will be recruiting a maths specialist who will lead on this work, working alongside the National Response for Improving Mathematics, and we will seek input from teachers later this year. This year, we will also see the Reform Bill laid before Parliament, progressing the establishment of the Centre for Teaching Excellence and decisions on the reviews I received last year. I remain committed to debating the proposals of the Independent Review of Qualifications and Assessment early this year, and it's crucial that those recommendations are thoroughly examined. Convener, this generation of young people had their formal education disrupted for nearly 2 years by a global pandemic. Last year, ongoing industrial action further hampered the continuity of schooling. And Scottish Government figures published back in December suggest that school attendance has fallen to a record low. Now, all of this is compounded by changes in behaviour and relationships in our classrooms, and indeed, evidence in England and Wales, which published last week by the Centre for Social Justice, spoke about the fraying disconnect between home and schooling post-pandemic. So Scotland's challenges are not unique, and reform can't sit in a vacuum of expectation, informed by that cosy consensus that Walter Hume warned the committee of. It must try to deliver improved outcomes for our young people. And indeed, as the ICEA argued last year, clear beneficial impacts of the learning experience of the young people and their teachers should be the acid test of any proposal. So reform needs to improve outcomes for our young people, build on the importance of quality learning and teaching, support our teaching workforce and engage parents and carers. And I look forward to answering the committee's questions and to hearing any suggestions that committee members may have.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Can I invite questions first from Willie Rennie, please?
So we're quite far into this reform programme. You could say it started in 2016. I'd just like to understand from the Cabinet Secretary what she thinks is wrong with Scottish education, was wrong then, that we're trying to fix.
What she thinks is wrong. I believe Mr Rennie has attempted to set a trap for me.
No.
So look, I think, Convener, I think there are many strengths in Scottish education. If I could just reflect, though, in 2015, the year prior to the year Mr Rennie cites, I was in the classroom. So I went through the last curriculum reform iteration as a teacher. And I think we need to learn lessons from the implementation of CFE through the implementation of any changes to the current qualifications, because there are things that I think we should do differently in the future. We need to engage the profession in that. We need to create time for the profession to be fully engaged in that. I don't necessarily think there are things wrong with Scottish education. What I would accept is that there are challenges. So we see that in the PISA data that published at the end of last year. I met with Professor Graham Donaldson, who the committee will be well acquainted with, just after my appointment in the summer last year. And we talked about some of the challenge in relation to the broad general education in the senior phase. One of the things I think is unresolved from curriculum reform in Scotland is that transition from BGE, the straight through curriculum, to senior phase. There's a disconnect. Now, I'm going to argue from a classroom teacher level or a head of department, part of this is actually about the hours you allocate to courses. It doesn't work when you timetable at the current time. So you kind of break the broad general education if you want to deliver more courses. So you've got variation in the system. So the committee knows, for example, I think the committee might have taken evidence on this. I know in the last session, Mr Greer and I certainly heard evidence on this in relation to the numbers of courses delivered in S4, for example. So I've got a report on my desk from Professor Louise Hayward, who talks about entitlements in the system. And that's a challenge to government. And I think that's something we need to resolve through reform. Because right now, we don't have entitlements. We have variation across the board in relation to the numbers of subjects that are delivered in schools. And I think that's something that we need to use reform to address and improve.
You've dug into quite a bit of detail, important detail. But I've never really had from any minister, any predecessor of yours, just a simple explanation as to why we slipped down the international rankings and why there's a yawning poverty-related attainment gap. I've never really had that explained properly, succinctly to me as to why that is. And it's clear that there's a recognition there's a problem because we've had an 8-year programme of education reform. Whatever you think of that, there's clearly a recognition that there is an issue, a problem, or you, as you describe it, a challenge. Uh-huh. But succinctly explain to me how we've got into this position.
So I don't think it's something that's happened since 2016.
No, I accept that. This is before, but it was recognised in 2016. So what was it that was recognised in 2016? Because nobody's explained it. Why have we embarked on this education reform if there was not something wrong?
So I don't think the current set of reforms, and forgive me, I wasn't in post in 2016, mirror those which existed in 2016. I think we're working in a completely different space to that which existed, certainly when I was first elected in 2016, and the changes that I think it would have been Mr Swinney at that time was bringing forward. We're living in a post-pandemic world, and I tried to kind of contextualise some of the challenge we face in Scotland not being unique to us. Mr Rennie spoke about why are we uniquely falling down the international league tables, as it were, in relation to the PISA data that published last year. We're not unique. And actually, if you look at other comparable countries, it was the PISA edition, the COVID edition, rather. But look, I made very clear, I think, in my statement to Parliament, we need to turn that trajectory around.
OK, no, I accept all the pandemic stuff. I don't know if I'm going to get anywhere with this, but I have been genuinely puzzled that the government has embarked on a 10-year programme of education reform without really being able to explain why. There was a kind of a panic in 2016. We set these really bold ambitions to close the poverty-related attainment gap, whether it was completely or substantially, whatever. There was an ambition at that point to do it, to try, in response to the PISA tables, to try and get us further up, whether you know, whatever you think of the validity. This is... my mission, Nicola Sturgeon said, this is my defining mission, this is something I'm going to... And now we've moved on from all that and we're now saying it's all about the pandemic. Surely we've got to recognise that there was something wrong. And my view is you had a ragtag bunch of reforms that didn't really cohere together because you didn't really understand what the problem was. Is that not right?
I don't think I would accept Mr Reddy's illustration of what happened
so what do
prior
you accept
to my time
then?
In office.
Why did we do all this?
Why do we do... Well, to Mr Rennie asked why we wanted to close the poverty-related attainment gap. I mean,
so
surely the answer should be obvious to him, that we want to ensure that children who live in poverty actually attain and go on to positive destinations.
So why did it happen then?
Why did it happen? Mm. Why did the poverty-related attainment gap...
Why did the education system allow the poverty-related attainment gap to get so wide, much more than other countries of similar types?
I'm not necessarily sure that you would say that Scotland's attainment gap is wider than any other comparable country. I don't have the data in front of me, but I don't think we're unique. I do think we were one of the first countries to identify the challenge. Actually, before a number of countries took action in this space, we said there's a problem here. And I guess this is a bit of a technical answer, but it's my honest opinion that in the past, historically, certainly when I was at school, I imagine when Mr Rennie was at school, although it's longer ago than when I was there, certain young people were encouraged to leave school after S4. They were basically told, do you know what, school's not for you, you're not bright enough. And we filtered them off somewhere else. And I think things have completely changed in our schools now. And I think that's as a result of, yes, reforms taken forward by this government and a different approach to how we measure success, which actually says, do you know what? If you're going on to study an apprenticeship, you're going on to study a course that might not be your traditional five hires offering, that has accreditation, that has merit too. So, like, I was in a school in Glasgow, for example, last week, where they were doing some fantastic work with the SEQS Ambassador Programme. Four confident young people presenting to me the work of their school and getting accreditation for it. In the past, we encouraged some young people, when I was at school in the 1990s, to leave school. And we said school and university wasn't for them. We have completely altered our approach to what education is about.
I accept that. Let's move on from that. I'm not sure I've got a clear answer. If we're saying that there is an expectation in the education world that we're going to have substantial reform, and I know the opinion is divided, and you said, there's basically a lot going on, big challenges, behaviour, absence, pandemic. We need to deal with these things and invest in teachers rather than structural reform. And I get that argument. Is that alone going to deal with the problems of the poverty-related attainment gap, which is still big, and the performance overall internationally? Is that going to be enough?
So I suppose my rebuttal to Mr Rennie might be in relation to how we quantify the poverty-related attainment gap and the role of schools. So we have this huge programme and this commitment to invest significant amounts of public money in closing the gap, but schools can only do so much. So our children spend on average about 20% of the time in school, 80% at home. And I think we've maybe in this mix need to remember the limitations to schools in relation to some of this work around about closing the gap. But on his second point on improving performance, that's where I think we can make a real difference in relation to how we invest in our teachers. We did that last year through the pay deal. We need to do more work, as we heard in the previous session from Ms Duncan Glancy. I'm sure we'll go on to talk about that too in relation to class contact time. But we really need to invest in the profession and recognise their role in driving improvement. And I think teachers will be key to ensuring we get to where we need to be in relation to improvement itself. He talks about this tension between substantial reform, the bodies, and all the reports I've got on my desk. And right now, we're going to come to the Chamber in a few weeks' time and have this wider debate on qualifications. And again, keen to hear views from members on that. But I am just really struck by the amount of pressure the education system is under, particularly our schools and particularly actually in secondary. And if you just reflect, I suppose the committee reflects on the fact that this was the first year since the pandemic that the SQA reintroduced some of the qualification requirements that existed before COVID. So some of our young people have never had to sit some of these internal assessments, the assignments that might sit alongside that. Suddenly they're being asked to do all these extra things. Teachers, many of them might not have delivered some of this course content previously because the SQA stripped it out. So I need to measure and balance very carefully changes that are coming in the future with the current reality, which, as we'll hear in the Chamber this afternoon, is a challenging one.
So I get that. My fear, though, is what your course of action is a bit more status quo and won't deliver the promise that you've made to make significant progress on overall performance and the poverty-related attainment gap. Are you not afraid that that might be the case? I understand the pressures, I get all that, but you're not afraid that I characterise it as the status quo, it's more than that. But are you not worried that if you don't drive forward more substantial change, you won't get substantial improvement?
Well, the status quo won't cut it. So Mr Rennie knows the PISA scores, and I've been really upfront about, for example, our approach to responding to the challenge in relation to maths education. So there is a challenge in relation to maths education. There's a challenge right now in relation to languages education. I'm sure we'll come on to talk about it. We need to look again at some of the courses that are delivered. I actually think that is not status quo. That's really bluntly looking at, for example, things like the role of knowledge within curriculum for excellence. Again, we heard critique about this at the end of term. I'm sure we'll come on to talk about that in a bit more detail. But we need to fundamentally look at some of the course content in relation to the delivery of CFE in the BGE to ensure that it's fit for purpose in the modern age, but also to update and refresh some of it. And in the maths curriculum in particular, having spoken to maths specialists, although I confess I am not one, there's a certain way in which our young people require to be taught maths in terms of building their learning, and that needs to be better supported across the system. So he's not going to hear the status quo from me, but I will come to Parliament with a plan in relation to the action that I intend to take. I am extremely mindful of lots of flux in the system just now in relation to the expectation built on from these reports. And look, I wasn't Cabinet Secretary during lockdown, nor during what happened in relation to the SQA. But at that moment in time, there was an anger in the system, and I still hear this from teachers around about the SQA and government, to be fair, during the examinations period, and a real frustration. And I was told when I was first appointed there was this real appetite for radical change in the system. But I would just gently suggest to the committee, if they engage with secondary teachers in particular, and in particular those who teach S4 and up, the degree of radical appetite for reform is maybe not as present as it might have been in the system in 2021.
Okay, so two quick fire questions then. One, I mean, the Hayward Review has basically got two elements: change the curriculum and change the qualification system. Mm-hmm. I mean, there's more than that, but that's, for me, central. Are you rejecting the extra columns of personal achievement and project work? Is that now gone?
Oh, sorry, I thought it was a supplementary to that. Well, I haven't yet responded to Professor Hayward's review, so I'm not going to respond in committee today. I haven't given up.
Just between us.
Just between us. Yeah, I'm not necessarily sure that's how it will work.
Nobody's watching.
I will respond formally to all of Professor Hayward's consultation. I think there are parts of it we will take forward. There will parts of it I will need to consider. And my consideration of some of this, because Hayward report in itself would be a substantive change to how we deliver qualifications in Scotland. What it needs to have happened to it, though, it needs to be translated into an action plan for schools to implement, and it's not there because it's not in that space yet. Now, to be fair to Professor Hayward, she talks about a 10-year plan. She talks about setting out how you would map change. But I'm a modern studies teacher that thinks about how would I timetable that? So these are the practical things that government needs to have an answer to that we don't yet in responding to her report. So I will respond to all of the recommendations.
So will we have that in time for the debate that you're proposing?
I can't imagine. I would like to hear your ideas first, Mr. Rennie, before I preempt my response.
You never do.
I think the committee is certainly looking for a definitive timeline as to when we can expect your response to the review. Please, that's the...
My response to... Well, it's not just Professor Hayward's review, of course. There's a plethora of different reports on my desk. And
yes.
I think the point I was making at the previous committee is we need to have a bit more connectivity between what's happening in the LLS space in relation to Mr. Day's responsibility. And
last week we were able to get a timeline of March from Mr. Day in response to something. So we are looking for something similar, at least a guidance for the committee as to when we can expect some information.
Yeah, I think we would also be working to similar timelines in relation to the end of March, so if that helps the committee.
Before that or after that?
Well, I would like to have the debate inform my response to the recommendations to ensure that I've heard all these ideas that Mr. Rennie and his colleagues have in relation to qualifications.
I have lots of ideas.
Good.
Lots of ideas from Mr. Rennie.
I look forward to hearing them.
Lots, as ever. So can we move now to questions from Michelle Thompson, please? Thank you.
Good morning and hello again. Last week in the Chamber, the Health Secretary gave a speech with which I strongly agreed, where he emphasised the need for culture change in some of the work that's going on there. And I intervened to comment that in my kind of previous life experience, changing culture as part of general change programmes is significantly the hardest thing to do. So my question for you is, in your opinion, and therefore do you back up what Professor Humes from Stirling University described as a cosy conformity in an evidence session here, that the culture within the civil service, don't take it personally, national agencies and local authorities needs to change, and if so, in what ways?
So I read some of the evidence the committee took from Professor Hume. I actually met with him in the summer after my appointment because he has expressed many views in relation to the Scottish Government's performance on a variety of different topics, I should say, over the years. But I think his points around about that cosy conformity is quite accurate. There's not a lot of grit in the system or challenge. Now, There's lots of grit directed my way because I am the lightning rod for grit. I'm the Cabinet Secretary. But I guess I go back to some of my response to questions from other members in the last committee around about accountability at local authority level. We seem to have forgotten in the mix that local authorities have that accountability. So we need to reset some of that. And there's an opportunity, I think, through Verity House to reset it. I talked about the accountability framework in my response to a member in the previous session. But we do need challenge and we do need grit. And sometimes we can get reliant in Scottish education on hearing from the same people about the same topics. I simply make this observation as a previous member of this committee and observing some of the witnesses that have already appeared. We need to hear fresh voices. We also need to hear from teachers. So, in the previous session, certainly, when Mr Greer and I were on this committee, we would take private evidence sessions with teachers. I don't know if the committee has explored that. I do know, I recall, when the committee were keen to come to my behaviour summits, teachers would not feel comfortable if they thought their views were being recorded for purposes like, for example, a parliamentary debate this afternoon. But they really benefit from private time with politicians listening to them. And the first school visit I undertook was at the school I taught in Edinburgh. And I asked my officials and Edinburgh Council representatives to leave the room and the head teacher so I could talk to the staff honestly about what was going on. That really helped to inform some of my thinking in the early days of taking up this post. So I think Professor Hume's absolutely right. There is a cosy consensus. We need a bit more challenge. I welcome the challenge. That's a huge part of the job of being a Cabinet Secretary. But we also need to ensure that those critical voices in the system, such as Professor Hume, are actually listened to and are not managed. Because, you know, some of the critique in Scottish education, we can't have a consensus on, and that's okay. To drive improvement, maybe we need to be a bit more honest about that, because consensus has delivered, to Mr Rennie's point, the status quo. Maybe challenge around some of the deliverability here is actually how you unpick some of that.
Well, I'm very heartened by what you've said, Cabinet Secretary, and going back to the cosy conformity, I just wonder how actively she's looked at, you've looked at diversity in the various roles that are in place, and particularly cognitive diversity and kind of cultural diversity. The tradition is always that you only have experts from the chosen field, but actually bringing in people from other areas as part of a mix, of course, because you do need the expertise. You know, we know that the data tells us that can be highly effective, and indeed the data also tells us that when you only have certain types of people from certain sectors, that can be fairly disastrous, thinking of the banking sector, for example, in private in 2008. So I'm just wondering what active consideration she's given to that in terms of roles you might seek to appoint or to refresh without mentioning any, getting any hairs running, obviously.
I suppose in terms of diversity, we have our first female chair of the SQA, so that's good, some progress in the qualifications body. I think more broadly in terms of diversity, it's maybe something we need to give a bit more thought to, because if you're talking about the advice I receive as Cabinet Secretary, primarily that will come from civil servants in Scottish Government, and to a large extent in relation to learning and inform, it will come from Education Scotland. And Education Scotland, when I was a staff member there many years ago, used to have a staffing complement that depended on secondments. That was quite a helpful system, I think, certainly in my experience, for coming out of the classroom, having a refresh, having the ability to engage with pedagogy, changes to the curriculum, and going back into the system. And the model that's now used in that organisation has pivoted away from secondments under, I think, the previous chief executive. So you've now got quite a static organisation. And I think we need to think again about how you refresh some of the thinking that I hear as Cabinet Secretary to ensure it's fresh, it's coming from the classroom, and it delivers, and it can deliver, some actual tangible improvements. So there's only so much I can do in terms of going out and engaging with teachers directly. I do that pretty much every week. But we need to, I think, probably to your point about diversity, if you go into a school, teachers have got the solutions. They know what's working, to Mr Rennie's point. They know what's not working. They know how they could fix it. So if you sit down with a group of teachers, they're always quite pragmatic, I think, in coming up with solutions. And there's something in that space, to Ms Thompson's specific point on diversity, about how we capture that in responding to Professor Hayward's review, but the other reviews that are sitting on my desk at the current time. There feels like, and certainly there felt like when I was first appointed, a bit of a disconnect between where we got to in relation to reform in terms of policy and all the different people, I should say, who fed into those reports, if you talk about consensus, and actually the reality of being a classroom teacher.
Thanks for that. And of course, it's not just in schools, it's in the wider, you know, key stakeholder groupings as well. But yeah. Moving on, one of the other things that's been talked about is empowerment in the system, and that kind of license to operate, if you like. And of course, there's how the Scottish Government can create an environment where teachers are empowered, given that actually you've got a part in the middle, which is, you know, got COSLA and local authorities. So it's almost like a question from a leadership perspective. What leadership can you put in place to ensure that teachers are empowered? And of course, that translates all the way through the system as well. So I'd appreciate your thoughts about that.
So back in 2018, when I think Mr. Swinney was Cabinet Secretary, we agreed a joint agreement between ourselves and COSLA, and we have since that time taken forward a number of actions in relation to the empowerment agenda. I think the committee took evidence on this from, was it SLS? I know there was an interest in that from them, understandably, given their members. So we have the headteacher's charter that looks at setting out how we could deliver a more empowered system. We have empowerment guidance for school leaders, for staff. You spoke as well, Ms Thompson, about the importance of other members that support school education, and we need to be cognisant of the role of parents in that as well, and the wider community too. Local authorities are really contingent, actually, on driving changes to the empowerment agenda. And in my experience, sometimes they can curtail that empowerment agenda. Mm-hmm. And I think the committee might have heard evidence to that end. I have certainly heard evidence to that end, whereby sometimes local authorities take a monolithic approach to their area, and it's a one-size-fits-all approach. And that can be really disempowering for headteachers. It can also mean that headteachers, and actually middle leaders in schools, as I experienced in a previous life, can be disempowered in things like the recruitment process, so they don't have the ability to appoint a member of staff to their team. These are the key kind of decisions that you would expect middle leaders and headteachers to have control over. But when local authorities view teachers as numbers that can be moved around from school to school, they're not really thinking sometimes about what's best for the leadership in that school, or for the teachers, I should say, in terms of their professional development, and for the young people too. So we have these resources that sit at national level, and there is, of course, the headteacher's charter. But I think to the substantive point that Michelle Thompson asked, Convener, the answer has to be in that new relationship with local government and Verity House. So it has to be about encouraging a spirit of empowerment across the country that isn't happening in pockets, because we know where empowerment does happen, it works well, staff feel valued, and actually outcomes improve too.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
You've spoken a lot there, Cabinet Secretary, about the different aspects of education reform and where they're all, and how you're looking to feed back on some of the, on your thoughts on that. So, in terms of how you're going about your business right now, how is implementation and evaluation being embedded into how you're thinking and the approach that you're taking as we're looking at what can be quite a complex future in terms of juggling all the reform that's ongoing?
So I think, as I set out in my opening statement, Convener, when I was first appointed, I was very struck by a number of things. Well, first of all, the number of reports that were landing on my desk in quick succession, and then by the reality of what my former colleagues were experiencing in our classrooms. And we have seen some of that play out in the Chamber in recent months, changes to behaviour, attendance, and then curriculum reform. Sometimes it is put by proponents of curriculum reform that it can solve all of some of these challenges. I'm not necessarily sure I would accept that, but I think there are opportunities through curriculum reform for it to provide a more engaging curriculum in some instances. In terms of evaluation, we are listening and engaging with the profession. So there were the 1,000 teachers that we engaged with towards the end of last year. We built in time as well. We asked local authorities to build in time and in-service days in August. Some did so in October, around about the changes being proposed by the Hayward Review, but also about the national discussion, which sometimes get lost in the mix, but actually sets out a vision for reform itself. And we will capture those views and ensure that they help to inform some of our thinking around about the legislative changes that will be required for both bodies. And of course, that legislation will be coming forward imminently. So I don't want to talk to the specifics of it because it has not yet been laid in Parliament.
Okay, thank you. Can I move to some questions from Pam Duncan Clancy, please?
Thank you, Convener, and welcome back, Cabinet Secretary. I want to take the theme of support for teachers a bit further and to talk about empowerment, but also from a bottom-up approach. So through your engagement with teachers, I'm sure you'll have heard about some concerns that they feel like decisions are taken out with their control, quite far away from them and not really on the front line, and then they're expected to deliver them in very difficult circumstances. So can I ask, how is the government balancing top-down leadership with a more bottom-up approach to curriculum reform?
So, a very good question, Ms Duncan Glancy, if I may say so. I think in the previous session we talked about the pay dispute and what that did to relations between government and the teaching unions and the profession actually is pretty well known to the committee. It has frayed relations, and I have been trying to make things a bit better in the last 8 months, but we're going to have to work differently and we're going to have to work together. And actually, the professional associations want to be part of the solution in terms of education reform. So Ms Duncan Glancy talks about bottom-up decision-making, and I suppose that perhaps talks to some of the challenge I was rehearsing in my response to Ms Thompson around about decisions being taken for you in education and feeling disempowered from the process. Head teachers have a degree of flexibility, but they can only exercise that if they're empowered to do so by their local authority. And quite often, a local authority might make a decision around about closing a building, for example, that a head teacher might have carried out a risk assessment on and be happy to have the building open, but they might be overruled by their local authority. These kind of things are really demoralising, and they, I think, can be quite challenging for leaders in schools, but for classroom teachers, some of the things that are taken out of your control. It'd be helpful to hear a little bit more from Ms Duncan Glancy. There are certain things that are taken out of your control as a classroom teacher. You might not have control over your timetable, for example, the classes that present in front of you. I'm talking as a secondary specialist, but primary teachers will talk about the year group, perhaps, that they might be planning for. Some of these things are not in their gift. So if there are ideas that Ms Duncan Glancy has around about how we can build that into the reform agenda, I'm happy to hear them. I do think to some extent the empowerment agenda it was a creation of the previous parliament, and we need to not forget about some of that work. It has to support education reform in the here and now. And I think probably returning to it to refresh people's understanding, particularly local authorities, would be helpful. I also think, though, to the point about the teaching workforce, we resolved the pay dispute, but we didn't talk about the other challenges that the profession are facing. And that, I think, speaks to the challenge that Ms Duncan Glancy has illustrated, whether that be on workload, additional support needs, behaviour. I'm sure we'll come on to talk about these things, if not now, then this afternoon. Mm-hmm. But we need to resolve that relationship around about conditions, and I don't think where we got to last year did.
Thank you, and I appreciate that answer. And I think part of the concern, as you'll be aware, is the time to be able to engage with any of this. And yeah. So if I can say so, I'm paraphrasing the Cabinet Secretary, I'm sure she'll set me right if I'm wrong, when she said earlier that support for the reforms among the teaching profession could be waning, I think might be the most polite way to say it, from the eager appetite for radical reform that maybe existed in 2021. Do you think that might have something to do with the fact that they've got immediate challenges right now in the classroom?
Yes, absolutely so. And also, to build on that, I think school, post-pandemic, is being expected, our schools, to mop up quite a lot of society's challenge. So we've talked already from Mr Rennie about the poverty-related attainment gap. The poverty-related attainment gap exists. It's not all of schools' creation, and yet we expect schools to mop up all of the challenge here. We need to have a much more holistic approach. And actually, part of this, I think, relates to how we budget across the Scottish Government. We need to have a much more holistic understanding of the inputs we're putting in as a government to the system to try and disrupt, because we cannot expect our schools to do everything. Mm-hmm. And they have... I mean, I joked earlier on about my being a lightning rod for political challenge, but schools, to some extent, are expected to do so much more now, even than when Ms Duncan Glancy and I were at school. You know, the expectation now on schools, when I go into schools and I see the extra things they are doing for our young people, I am blown away. And yes, part of that is funded by the additionality from PEF and SAC. But part of it, I think, is societal expectation that school, a teacher put it to me a few weeks ago, will step into the breach where other services can step back. School is a constant in a child's life. So I think I understand and I agree with Ms. Duncan Glancy's point, and I think we need to reconsider how we can pull other services into supporting schools, because they can't do it alone, and we are expecting more and more from them.
And I agree with the Cabinet Secretary on that point, and being in the position that she is, what does she intend to do about it?
Well, I think part of it, and I think I outlined this in my response to Ms Thompson in the previous session, is Verity House. It has to be about a new way of working between local authorities and government. And that will mean, to the point that Walter Hume's made, challenge between government and local authorities, but accountability and honesty about where that responsibility rests. So we need to disrupt the poverty-related attainment gap. That has to be about a funded and a well-supported education system, but it isn't just about the education system, it's about the round. So, for example, there are a number of schools now that have shared services with other, whether that's social work or other support services from third sector, for example. I think that approach can be really beneficial to schools who are trying to wear so many hats and respond to so many challenges that they just can't do all of this on their own. And I think there needs to be a greater recognition of that at local level. And to Ms Duncan Glancy's question, what am I going to do about it? Well, my response to that would be that through the reform process, we look to give a bit more clarity and a bit more of a steer to what the ways in which schools are able to be supported. So it's not just about us thinking narrowly, as we're doing today, understandably, about the education budget. We need to think about the other parts of budgets, say she, during the budget negotiation process, that can help to disrupt some of the challenge here. Because I can't recall who quoted the Health Secretary earlier, I think it may have been you, Convener. There are interventions that the Health Secretary can make from his budget that will help to close the poverty-related attainment gap, and vice versa, I'm sure. But there is an opportunity, I think, to have a refocusing of how we think about the role of education through reform.
Thank you. That was appreciate that. Michelle Thompson made that reference to the...
Sorry.
Have you concluded?
Just briefly? Okay, thank you. Those conversations across government will be very interesting, particularly around local government budgets, I would imagine. Finally then, given what we've just discussed, is the Cabinet Secretary concerned, as I am, that there's a reduction to about £7.7 million from the support for teachers budget this year, given what we've just discussed?
So that reduction, as I understand it, is a demand-led budget line in the main, and it is from initial teacher education places that were not filled. So there was an oversupply of places this year. That calculation is set out, I think, by the SFC, but that's where that reduction has come from. So there shouldn't be an adverse impact in that regard. These are places that were simply not filled.
Thank you. Detail of another demand-led budget line. They're all coming out in the wash as the conversation progresses today. Can I move to Stephanie Callaghan now, please? Thank you, Stephanie.
Thanks very much, Convener. I want to ask about curriculum content, and we heard from Professor Stobart about, not learning in a vacuum, and that need for the mastery of information, facts and basics in order to be able to think about them and use them. So I'm wondering, is it the intention of the review is that there will be more explicit guidance on the content of the curriculum in broad general education, and what's the role of government and its agencies in providing guidance on curriculum content?
So we don't have a prescriptive curriculum in Scotland under Curriculum for Excellence, and we might come on to talk about some of the challenge here in relation to what that means in terms of subjects. But there is flexibility in the broad general education because of the theory of CFE, which essentially allows teachers and local decision makers, head teachers, to decide on the curriculum content for their local context. You ask Ms Callaghan about specific guidance, and of course Education Scotland has a role to provide that guidance. Sometimes the challenge to government is we don't need more guidance, we need more prescription. And towards the end of last year, I was listening to some of the critique around PISA, and there are some advocates of us bringing in much more prescription back to the curriculum in Scotland, some who say there has been too much flexibility. I think we need to balance that very carefully. That's why, of course, I've committed to the curriculum improvement cycle, starting with maths education. I have to say, predicated on the PISA results, but also looking and considering some of the examination results from National 5 Maths this year too, we need to improve the delivery of the maths curriculum. We will then move on to look at English and literacy more broadly. But that explicit guidance can be provided by Education Scotland. I suppose my question to the committee, and something for us to consider in the wider debate about qualifications reform, is that what the system's looking for? explicit guidance? Is it looking for prescription? Because the way in which we deliver CFE does not prescribe curriculum content. But some advocate that we should have a level of prescription. Now, there's a tension here between the founding principles of actually curriculum for excellence and how it operates as a curriculum. But maybe these are things we need to consider in the broader mix of qualifications reform. And I'd be keen to hear views on that, because there are some in the system who say we have gone too far in relation to flexibility. And actually what teachers are looking for is a bit more prescription, a bit more direction to help them set out the learning outcomes for their young people.
No, it's really good to hear that you're looking at that balance. I think you're absolutely right on it there. Also wanted to ask about curriculum review as well, about will that include an ongoing focus on wellbeing and specifically on anxiety? I'm interested in whether we can look at imparting knowledge on why young people continue to feel anxious, and about giving young people themselves perhaps a deeper understanding of what's going on in their brain, why they're anxious, and the tools to actually tackle that perhaps effectively. So almost like an early intervention, if you like, as well, to stop that progressing into something more serious.
Yeah, I mean, I thank Ms Callan for her question. She'll know that we prioritise support for wellbeing in our schools through the provision of counsellors in every secondary school, and wellbeing in terms of curriculum for excellence and the expectations of that curriculum is a responsibility for all. So all teachers have a responsibility to ensure the wellbeing of their young people. And she spoke about the anxiety, particularly in our young people. I'm always struck by, yes, the impact of the pandemic on all of us, but particularly on our young people, and how that has impacted on their development, on their brain actually, and how they consume information. We've had great debates in the Chamber in recent times about the use of mobile phones. I saw some members on them earlier on during the budget session. And I think we need to be mindful that the way in which our young people consume information, the way in which we all consume information, has changed. And that can also lead to an increase in relation to anxiety. I think we need to look at this issue in a bit more detail. Part of the challenge in relation to behaviour and changes in behaviour, I think, is also informed by an increasing sense of anxiety and worry. And actually, there was some evidence that we published last year about our young people feeling safe returning to school after the pandemic, and most of them, I think it was in the PISA. Yeah, it was in PISA, enjoying being back at school, enjoying the stability that that brought, which was certainly heartening to see. We want our young people to enjoy coming to school, and we don't want them to be anxious going out into the world without those supports. So it's a responsibility of all. Teachers should be supporting, and they do support their young people in relation to their wellbeing. But I do think more broadly we need to consider anxiety in our response to changes to behaviour and how we can better support it. I don't know, Claire, if you want to say more on...
No, I think you've covered it.
I'm happy with that. I think it's good that you're going to be looking at that in more detail. Thank you.
Thank you, Stephanie Callahan. Can we move now to questions from Ruth Maguire, please?
Thank you, Convener, and good morning again, Cabinet Secretary. Regarding the curriculum, I'd like to talk about breadth of choice in secondary. The committee heard from Dr. Marina Shapira and Professor Mark Priestley about their research last year. And if I can share a quote with you, Dr. Shapira told the committee, "We found some absolutely appalling practices, such as channelling young people into higher performing subjects, discouraging them from taking up subjects in which they were not predicted to perform well, and abandoning whole subjects that were deemed to be low performing, but that might have been very important for providing a holistic, well-rounded education. For us, the culture of performativity was one of the main issues standing in the way of successful implementation of curriculum for excellence." Listening to some of your previous interactions there with perhaps particularly Willie Rennie, it struck me that the first part of that quote could actually have been plucked from any time in education. It's not necessarily specific to curriculum for excellence, and I think there's maybe just a bit of a challenge in that. You'll be aware of that research. I'd be interested to hear your reflections on it. I suppose they spoke about a reduction in the number of national qualifications entries at S4 compared to the period prior to the introduction of Curriculum for Excellence. They spoke about significant curricular fragmentation in many schools, with pupils having a large number of teachers.
I think as well, going back to your bit there about prescription versus, you know, a sort of open-ended thing, could it be the case that without having prescription, that there is that temptation to steer into subjects that just perform well for the schools?
It could be. I suppose my reflection, I'm trying to recall the name of the academic, Mr Greer may recall, we certainly in 2018-19 took evidence on this exact topic at this exact table from an academic who was a former head teacher. Do you recall, Mr Greer?
And he brought his spreadsheet, printed out his spreadsheet. Yes. I can't remember his name, sorry.
I think he was a friend of Ian Gray, so I was suspicious of him. But anyway, set that aside. So at that point in 2018-19, we already had the evidence that talked about subjects reducing in S4. The counter-argument to which would be, well, we have a broader curriculum now up to the end of S3. But actually, I suppose I go back to my point to Willie Rennie. He asked me what's wrong with Scottish education. Well, nothing's wrong with it. We've got a strong education system. But we didn't fix the break between BGE and the senior phase. And that is part of the challenge in relation to course choice, because this is about the practical delivery. And this is why, in my response to Professor Hayward's review, I am thinking very carefully about how this will work in schools. Because when Ms McGuire and I were at school, you would sit maybe 7, 8, in some schools, 9 standard grades. But across the country, there would be probably in the 7 or 8 region. We now have, you could walk into a school down the road, they might be sitting maybe 5 qualifications, and in another school, they might have adhered to the 2-2-2 model, the traditional model, and not really moved very much away from their theory of thinking around about the curriculum at all, because they want to stick to Ms McGuire's point around about performativity, and they believe that's the best way to deliver results for their young people. There's a challenge in that. I guess it goes back to the points I was making around about whether or not we have a prescriptive curriculum in terms of entitlements as well. But I do think part of the response to curriculum changes and updating and responding to some of the curriculum improvement cycle work has to address the gap between the BGE and the senior phase. And if I can be really very niche orientated, given I had to write a timetable in a previous life, the hours that the SQA currently ascribes to national qualifications mean that you cannot timetable more than, now Mr Greer will keep me right, but I think it's 5 subjects in S4. Unless you start delivery of the national qualifications in S3, that breaks the BGE. So we need to have an answer to this link between, so most schools will start the delivery of their national qualifications subjects a bit earlier in S3 to account for that hour delivery associated with the qualification. But our new qualifications organisation has got to talk to the folk that write timetables in schools. And I think in the past, there's been a disconnect. Never the two shall meet. Now, we need to think about the practicalities of this, because if we're unpicking the qualifications, these are the things that teachers will be responding to. And to your point, Ms McGuire, about S4 entries, that's how we look to, I suppose, give a bit more equality, I suppose, across the provision. And that's Professor Hayward's challenge around about entitlements. So there's an opportunity through reform to fix some of the challenge in the system just now without necessarily unpicking all of it. And I think part of that is fixing where we get to between the broad general education and the implementation of the senior phase. And there's lots of ways in which you can avoid the two-term dash, as it's often referred to. You can deliver qualifications across 2 years. You know, many schools actually are already doing that because they think it delivers better outcomes for their young people. But it will also move us away from a system which has 3 years of exams. And as the committee will know and will have taken evidence on, we like a test in Scotland. And there's an argument that we need to broaden out what we constitute as assessment and how we measure outcomes for young people.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary was being very generous, indicating that we might have been at school at the same time. I think I was a tiny bit ahead of you, but thank you for that.
I shall not comment, Ms. McGuire.
She was very, very polite to me.
Of course I commented on you.
I suppose, thinking about that, when I was at school, you took A Science, yes. one of the three, mm-hmm. a language for a number of years. Mm-hmm. That doesn't happen now.
Nope.
And I reflect, we had the members' debate yesterday about modern languages mm-hmm. in Aberdeen University. And I wonder if we're not, if we might have a situation where if young people are being funnelled to where they're likely to perform well or where there's perhaps not the demand, so it might be hard to take modern languages in schools, that some of that breadth and less prescription is actually could narrow that aspect of things for young people.
Yeah, I mean, the counter to that is, in the past, we used to compel young people to take subjects that they absolutely hated. Mm. So
chemistry.
Yeah, so, I mean, you go and speak to... Well, indeed, I have flashbacks to standard A chemistry myself. But you go and speak to secondary teachers, and they would tell you stories about teaching some of their classes in S4 who hated their subject and didn't want to be there. So we need to be a bit careful here, because some young people don't want to necessarily study physics and chemistry until the end of S4. And yet the way in which their timetable offer might be constructed suggests that's how those are essentially, I suppose, funneled in that direction. Mm-hmm. Some schools, though, I have to say, are really good at building a timetable around about pupil choice. So I've seen it done in schools before whereby they ask their young people what they want to study and they build the timetable according to pupil choice. Mm-hmm. That's a much more democratic way of building a timetable. Others use a more traditional method, which looks at how many staff and teachers they've got and timetables them accordingly.
It's good to hear you say that. I think we hear quite a lot about what teachers are looking for, and I would not diminish teachers' experience and their importance in this, but I guess it's about what young people and children look to.
And I think that point on demand is an important one. So I remember when I was teaching in 2015, I had two or three young people who wanted to study advanced modern studies. I mean, there is a question about whether or not you should run a course with three people and one well-paid middle leader in a school. So another school in the town in which I taught at that time was delivering advanced higher modern studies. So the young people went to that school to receive that qualification. So demand has a role to play, and I think we should be mindful of that as well. But the other point I think Ms. McGuire mentioned was around about discouraging certain subjects who, you know, they might not do well in. When I was teaching in Edinburgh, I remember we had a whole school policy at that time, which was that if a pupil did not attain 33.33% in their prelim, they could not sit the final exam. And I remember in 2011, the head teacher at that time coming to a whole staff meeting to talk about us moving away from this policy, because the city had a policy, informed by Scottish Government policy, I should say, to close the gap, and that meant that these young people should have the opportunity to sit a final exam. That was a real culture shift for, I should say, the staff in that school, including myself at that time, which was essentially, well, if they haven't attained this, they should not be allowed the opportunity to sit the qualification. We have moved so far beyond that point now that we are now presenting young people for qualifications. Now, you could, a counter argument to that, Ms. McGuire, might be some of these young people might not be ready for qualifications. I think the answer in this is continuous assessment. That is one of the recommendations that flows from Hayward. That's how you track, monitor and you support your young people throughout the year, and you ensure they're ready for any final qualification. But we also need to think about the percentage associated with the final qualification. At the moment, we have most qualifications having a high weighting to that final exam. That puts a lot of pressure on young people. So the argument from Hayward is that we look more generally at how we allocate marks, I suppose, throughout the year to continuous assessment. I think we should be mindful of the opportunities that provides us in that regard as well.
Okay, I think we've covered a number of the factors that might make it challenging for schools to provide a broad offer in senior phase, but and you have answered this in some part, but I just wonder if you had any more to say about what government might do to help mitigate any of those barriers or challenges that schools face.
So, in part, some of the barriers that schools face, I suppose, go back to this challenge between prescription and flexibility. We have an extremely flexible curriculum. Some say it's too flexible. I think we only mandate maths and English until the end of S4, so everything else is optional. And perhaps, and I'm keen to hear from the committee, that's something we should consider. It's not in one of the many reports on my desk at the current time. I don't think it's a direct recommendation from Hayward around about prescription. It kind of would fly in the face of CFE. But the argument for flexibility also has to meet the needs of learners. And sometimes there's a challenge there, because sometimes, I know from experience, courses run because it depends on which staff you've got in front of you. That's not necessarily meeting the needs of those learners. So we need to think through reform about how we can deliver on those entitlements that Professor Hayward talked to. And perhaps that means us looking at some of the thorny issues around about prescription. I think it will be challenging. And I do, I suppose, go back to thinking about that fourth year class with a number of young people in front of you who don't want to be there and don't want to study your subject. But there is something about us having a breadth of offer in our curriculum. And CFE gives that breadth of offer until the end of S3, where it's meant to. How do we ensure that throughout the qualifications? Mm-hmm.
Thank you. We've got a number of supplementaries on this theme. If we can keep them brief, that's okay. Ross, and then Liam. I was looking directly at Ross.
Thanks, Convener. Not even a supplementary, but just for the sake of the official report, I found the name is Professor Jim Scott at Dundee Uni, who gave the evidence that the Cabinet Secretary and I heard last session. Yeah. And what he found was that it was just over half of schools in Scotland were offering six courses in S4. About a third were offering seven, about one in 11 were offering eight courses, mm-hmm. and there were three or four offering five. So presumably that was the three or four who were doing a two-year higher. Mm.
Thank you for that, Ross Greer. Liam Kerr?
Yes, thank you. Just very briefly, I thought Ruth McGuire raised a very important point there about the debate last night on modern languages. One of the things that came out from a number of contributors was the importance of modern languages, both to the young people involved, but also to our global ambitions and to our economy. That is the context where 1,500 fewer pupils are studying languages at NAP 5, yeah. and 1,000 fewer, over 1,000 fewer, are taking it higher. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree with the importance of modern languages? And if so, what are you doing about those figures?
Well, I'm not going to use my rusty higher French in responding to Mr. Kerr, but on this issue, at the end of on this issue, at the end of last year, there were a number of different reports around about, first of all, the provision of languages courses at Aberdeen University. I met with the principal, actually, to discuss this very issue towards the end of last year. And as I understand it, the issue at that university, although it is an issue for that university, who are independent of government, is dependent on footfall. So they don't have the numbers driving the availability of courses anymore. But I accept the challenge around about languages. I have asked to engage with Education Scotland on this very point. I met with officials actually last week to look again at our languages policy and how we're supporting that. We've done a lot of work in our primary schools around about the 1+2 model to support the delivery of languages learning, which sees our young people learning two languages. And I think there's more in that space we could look to support. But Mr. Kerr's substantive point goes back to Ms. Maguire's point around about whether or not you prescribe in the curriculum that languages learning should be until the end of S4. That is not the curriculum we currently have. If that is a view that Mr. Kerr would like to explore with me in relation to qualifications reform, I'm happy to hear it. He and I both have a qualification in languages. I actually found it very helpful in conversing with Marie Goujon's husband, of course, who comes from France. But in seriousness, it's helpful to have a language, a second language. It helps your development. I spoke to a friend of mine who's a former German teacher recently, and she spoke about the joy of languages learning. And I think we need to be mindful of some changes to curriculum for excellence. So I suppose to go back to Mr. Rennie's what's wrong with Scottish education, it's the link between BGE and senior phase we need to consider. But we also need to consider the role of subjects. And actually in a secondary school, where we have subject specialists with degrees and teaching qualifications to deliver them, they need to be part of the solution here. And I do think we need to be mindful of changes to CFE that might be driving uptake or changes to uptake in our courses where we have less language learning than we would have had in the past, because when Mr. Kerr and I were at school, although he's obviously older than I am, we had to study a language until the end of S4. So we probably all in this room have a qualification, maybe not Mr. Greer, from S4 in languages learning. But the generation who follow us will not, because they are not compelled to do so by a curriculum which is flexible. So the challenge to that is, or the counter to that is, you prescribe. So that would be very, very different to the curriculum we have at the current time. But if that's a view that the committee holds, I'm happy to hear it. And obviously we'll have a wider debate around about qualifications in the next few weeks.
Yes, thank you. You spoke in your remarks to Ruth McGuire about somehow some schools can timetable the variety. So I was interested, we've also heard in one of our sessions prior to Christmas about the role of AI in education. Do you think there might be scope to investigate ways that AI can help with that timetabling dilemma? And are we looking to find solutions? Because I think there may be something that may be available?
Yes, I think AI gives us a number of opportunities. I know the committee's written to me specifically on this, so I will provide a substantive response in that written response. But obviously, through the Hayward Review, she makes a number of recommendations, Professor Hayward, in relation to AI. And in my conversations with Graham Donaldson during the summer, we spoke about how AI could be used in the future to reduce teacher workload. So I think these are the things we need to explore through reform. Timetabling is an extremely political subject with any secondary teacher you may speak to as a committee. We used to joke that a deputy in a former school I worked in was locked in a cupboard for a week to write the timetable because it was such a stressful job to do, to pull all that together. So if there are opportunities through AI, then I'm very keen to explore that, particularly in relation to reducing teacher workload. And I would see a role for Education Scotland in that regard. I know the committee took evidence, I think, from Ollie Bray on AI. But Education Scotland should have a key role to play in developing guidance that can help to reduce teacher workload, whether that be on timetabling or on other issues that AI might be able to support. I feel as though we're at the beginning of our journey in relation to AI. It's changing every day. And the qualifications reform as well will need to be developed in response to some of those changes because it's so fast-paced. The university sector has a lot, though, we can learn from too, but I'm happy to give a substantive response to the That'd committee on AI specifically.
I suppose in terms of our last session, we were talking about teacher contact time, and there was a bit of pressure from one of the members about if they could... It's one of these spend-to-save agenda items, you know, the investment of the technology could make significant impact, and as you've said, the pace of change in this sphere is mind-blowing. So can I move now? I'm looking to Bill Kidd, please. Thank you very much.
And thank you, Convener. When I was at school and the Cabinet Secretary was a senior teacher, I thought I'd get that in first there, actually. Thank you. can I just ask, if you don't mind, about how the performance of schools should be measured on the basis that there's in many places a culture of performativity, you know, how the school does is what really matters to the greatest extent, and whether that could be removed and decisions about pupils' learning and certification are focused on what's best for the pupil rather than how the school registers as being successful. You know, it's important that schools are there in order to provide the very best that they can for the community and for the pupils who attend, rather than being able to actually have themselves marked up as being the place to go or whatever, you know.
But that's the reality, is it not, at the current time, Mr. Kidd? And I think we all accept and we can see that. Part of the challenge here, I suppose, is to some extent, and I may pass the clear on this, it's the way in which we measure performance. So the National Improvement Framework that we have in government looks at a broader range of measures than local authorities look at. They will look at the five hires measure, I think. So there's a bit of a disconnect there that we're working to resolve. I might just pass to Claire on that specific point around about that variation.
Sure. So in relation to the National Improvement Framework, the basket of measures that are covered in that cover a broad range of trying to look at the entirety of performance, and the purpose of having the National Improvement Framework is to have that golden thread from the classroom right back up to looking at a national level at Scottish education's performance and improvement journey. We are working closely with colleagues in local government and COSLA around the different measure that local authorities use, the local government benchmark framework, and to see how much we can pull that together, because that rounded measure, that it's not just about five hires or any one particular measure that can really assess a school's performance. So that's something that we're looking at very closely at the minute.
But if I can just observe, there's a bit of a disconnect between some of the arguments around a culture of performativity and then PISA. I mean, I have to be honest with the committee, PISA is a raw data set that tells the government a very challenging story. And if the culture is of, if we're moving away from a culture of performativity, then I have to ignore PISA? I don't think so. I think that data set tells me a story that I need to respond to. And actually, that's one of the reasons we've rejoined other international surveys that we had previously not been part of for a number of years, to give me more data. And if we go back to, I think I referenced this in the chamber at the end of term in the last education debate we had, Mr. Kerr, and it was around about the role of PISA and the history to it, which was at the time an American president in the 1980s looking for objective data from states around about education performance. That's the origins of PISA. It's about driving improvement. So I don't think you should ignore necessarily culture performativity. Okay, I hear some of the challenge here. But we also need to improve, and PISA gives us a data set to help support improvement, and that's why we're investing in these other surveys. But it's why we need to engage in the substantive detail, and so do local authorities, around about their responsibilities in terms of their outcomes for young people.
If I just, I think there's a key difference between performativity, so how a school responds to the measures that they think are about their performance, and actually the broader improving the performance of Scottish education, and that's what we need to focus on.
Yeah.
Okay, well, thanks very much. I mean, it's important, as you say, to remember the overall picture, which actually is that we want to improve Scottish education to as great a degree as possible. I'm just wondering about how that always relates to what is best for the individual pupils who attend a school, and how their aims and aspirations can be improved upon as well.
I think the best intervention you can make, or the best investment a government can make, is in a quality teaching workforce. That's why, of course, we have the best paid teachers in the UK. We want to work with the profession on supporting them. That's why I think Ms Duncan Glancy's points in the last session around about class contact were absolutely spot on, and I support her in that endeavour. Doesn't mean I don't have challenges in relation to my budget, but I hope she heard from me that I think reducing class contact is part of how you can improve a learner journey throughout their education system, supporting the workforce that educate them. It's also one of the reasons that I made an announcement around about the Centre for Teaching Excellence, and I see some opportunity through that model to help support the profession in terms of their professional development. I gave the example, I think, earlier on to, to Michelle Thompson, it may have been to another member, sorry, around the role of Education Scotland in the past, that would allow you to come out of school and to refresh your knowledge. We've moved away from that model. I want the Centre for Excellence to give opportunities to staff to really promote professional learning and to encourage, I suppose, and embed that spirit of professionalism that's already in the teaching profession. And I think that's how you support young people, is by investing in your teachers.
Okay. Thank you very much, Anna. Thank you.
Thank you. Ben McPherson, please, now. Thank you.
Thank you, convener. Just before I ask my question, it's anecdotal, but I think what the Cabinet Secretary said around conditions earlier and wanting to address some of the concerns from the profession on that were really well-made points. Certainly, during the pay dispute, the vast, vast majority of emails that I received as a constituency MSP were more about conditions than they were actually about pay. I also think what's been stated around taking the teaching profession with us, so to speak, with regard to reform is so important. I was also working in a school when Curriculum for Excellence was introduced, and certainly the anecdotal feedback then was it was perhaps slightly rushed, and much of that was due to political pressure. So I think all of us would be well served and would serve our constituents better if we keep that in mind as we, yes, work towards reform at a reasonable pace, but do it in a way that is considerate of the pressures on the profession. So I just think those were important points that you made, Cabinet Secretary. Moving to the question I wanted to ask, which relates to the fact that reform isn't just about practicalities and processes, but it's also about approach and attitudes. And we've heard much through the different reports and through the different discussions and evidence sessions that we've undertaken and that have been published around parity of esteem. And it's so important for how we meet the needs of the 21st century and reform in that regard. So how is the government ensuring that parents and carers and family members have a strong and better understanding in many instances of the different learning pathways and opportunities available for children and young people into apprenticeships as well as further and higher education into the workplace? And how are we going to change the sometimes unhelpful, but the various examples where there is kind of prejudice in our society that, you know, some routes are better than others? We've done a lot in that space, but we need to do more.
I thank Mr McPherson for his question. On CFE being rushed, I think
Mr Russell was Cabinet Secretary when we implemented changes to curriculum qualifications. But I think we delayed it by a couple of years in response to the teaching profession. I was out of the classroom at the time, but I was writing resources to support the implementation of the qualifications. So we did delay it, I think, 2 years. And then we delayed the implementation of the new hire as well, at the behest of the teaching unions. But I agree with Mr McPherson, the premise behind how you implement qualifications reform, we need to think very carefully about how we deliver that on the ground. Sometimes there's a bit of a disconnect between what Cabinet Secretaries or Ministers may say in the Chamber and the reality in our communities. And particularly given that education is delivered locally, we need to really think about how this is delivered and communicated and how staff are supported, how they're given the time to develop. I remember trying to write support materials for the new qualifications because the SQA had published part of the documentation. We need to think about the role of the new qualifications organisation in all of this. And I guess I go back to Louise Hayward's observations that this is going to take time and we need to set out that trajectory, that plan for implementation of changes to qualifications in the future, because it will be a big change for the profession if I accept all of the recommendations in that report. And I'm keen to hear views on that when we have a wider debate. On reform, approach and attitudes, on parity of esteem, I think the SEQF have got a really strong role to play here. I was in a school in Glasgow last week whereby, I think I spoke about this in the previous session, they had a number of young people involved in the school ambassador programme. Their accreditation of qualifications is really important in relation to setting out the value that qualifications have to parents and carers, so that parents and carers understand that a higher English might be benchmarked to something that has the same number of points attached to it. So that's hugely important. And the young people at that school in Glasgow were telling me about the approach their school uses. So they have careers fairs. They have their teachers sitting at different desks telling them about qualifications that they might never have heard of. So I think, I'm looking at Claire, but she wasn't there. I don't know. There was a, you weren't there either, Laura. Well, from memory, there was a qualification in criminology. And the young people, one of the young people there was telling me that she's now going to university to study criminology because she had this approach to qualifications from one of her teachers. And they told them about the use of this qualification and what it could lead on to in terms of future careers. So I sometimes think we prescribe too much. And we've had a conversation about flexibility, but actually schools are doing this work anyway. So part of the reform agenda needs to pull together a bit more consistency. I think Skills Development Scotland, obviously, and the Career Service in particular, have a role to play here. I was in Glenrothes High School in my own constituency before school. They have an embedded representative from SDS in that school, careers officer rather, and he knows all of the kids in that school. And there are kids that have left that school and come back to him for advice. And he was embedded in that school community. Not every careers advisor works in that way. And I know Mr Day spoke at the committee last week about the role of career service and how that might change in the future. This is why I think my opening comments, you can't divorce what's happening in that space from wider school reform. Careers parity of esteem has to be part of our response too. I think we do have a much better understanding now of parity of esteem than we did when certainly Mr McPherson and I were definitely at school at the same time, although I think he might be younger than me. I think it has changed, but there is more we will need to do in that space. But when I go into schools, I'm always blown away by the number of qualifications they're now running, the breadth of offer. I know we've talked about narrowing curriculum to some extent. And perhaps if you consider traditional subjects, there is a truth in that. But you could look at subjects like criminology that are now delivered in schools, like higher photography, for example. There are a range of other qualifications being delivered in schools now, which I think speaks to Mr McPherson's ask around parity of esteem and the value that schools place on these qualifications.
I think we do need to get more comfortable as a society with a differentiation of positive destinations. And, you know, going back to the discussion earlier and what's been in the public discourse in the last few days around university place numbers, if more young people, for example, go into apprenticeships or directly into the workplace because that's the right route for them to flourish, then I think we need to get comfortable that that might have an impact on the number of young people going to university. And that isn't necessarily a negative thing. So we're at the beginning of that. Well, we're not at the beginning. It's developed to a reasonable extent, but I think we've got some way to go to really get to a place where whatever the young person thinks is best for them and their abilities we celebrate that as a society and help them on their journey.
Absolutely, and I recognise the member's point. I think there's still a hierarchy that we haven't yet got to where we should in relation to parity of esteem. And I know James Withers makes these points pretty vociferously in his report. We need to better understand that. What I would just reflect is that I think our schools are doing a really good job just now around those pathways and around apprenticeships. The number of schools I now visit where colleges are coming in to deliver some courses or young people are leaving in the afternoon. So in Glenrothes High School, they were going to the college in the afternoon to study a course in childcare at the college in Glenrothes. You know, these things in the past might not have happened. There is much greater connectivity across the education system than ever before.
I agree with that, and I think your point around consistency, and the Minister made these same points last week, around young people being aware of what's available to them is the crucial next step.
Absolutely that, and that's why the Career Service and SDS, of course, have a key role to play in that endeavour, and it's also why we can't divorce school reform from the wider skills agenda that Mr Day is leading on.
I am conscious of time, and I know we've still got quite a bit to go through, actually, and I do want to get it all covered today. Ross Greer, please. Thanks.
Thanks, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, I'd be interested in getting a sense from you on direction of travel around the new body, specifically the new qualification body and governance arrangements. There's been a lot of criticism. I've been one of the people who's made that criticism of the governance structure of the SQA, the fact that, you know, for example, there's three management consultants on the board, but only one current teacher. And I'm interested in your thoughts on the balance in governance arrangements between having individuals appointed to board positions who have knowledge and experience of the area that public body is responsible for. So in this case, knowledge and experience of education versus corporate governance, because both are important. My feeling is we don't currently get that balance right, and I'd be interested in your sense of what are your aspirations for the board and governance arrangements of the new bodies.
So I think on the face of it, I think Mr Greer's point about getting it right is an important one. We do have a new chair, of course, in the SQA, and I think Shirley Rogers will be key to driving some of the cultural change we need to see in the organisation. We do need to change our ways of working, and part of that is having teacher voice embedded in the governance arrangement. So we will embed that through having teacher expertise on the board in a way that perhaps it might not have been prescribed previously. And I've been very keen to set that out in relation to our governance expectations. Claire may want to say more in relation to the role of teacher voice in that, but certainly as we move to a new qualifications organisation, teacher voice has to inform particularly how qualifications are developed, delivered. And to be fair to the SQA, teachers are involved in the writing of qualifications just now. It's classroom teachers and promoted teachers who mark exam scripts every year. They write the exams. So they are involved in the qualifications. But in the governance challenge, I think Mr Greer identifies an opportunity. And I think in the draft governance arrangements that we've been considering, there will be an opportunity to embed teacher voice more so, and the voice of learners additionally.
Yes, yeah, so just to add to that, I think there's a balance between the appropriate governance for a non-departmental public body, but there is an ability through the legislation to make some clear recommendations around the membership of the board appointments to embed that teacher voice, as the Cabinet Secretary has said. And then also through the wider governance arrangements, both through whatever new advisory council that's in place, but also whatever committee structures that support the overarching board, to ensure that teacher practitioner voice and indeed learner voice is embedded and is clear in terms of that overarching governance. So that's the aim.
Thanks, Raj. I think that learner voice as well as teacher voice is really important there. And there are, you know, there's other perspectives, parents and carers, for example, who can make a valuable addition. Cabinet Secretary, you made the point earlier of the model that Education Scotland used to use more of seconding staff in and have moved away from more recently. Do you see opportunities for that, not just in the reformed Education Scotland, but also in the new qualifications body, perhaps the inspectorate? You mentioned that there's not enough grip in the system at the moment. Part of the criticism to take the current inspection system is that many of those going in to inspect schools, professional as they are, have not themselves been in a classroom for quite some time. Do you think that there's more of a role for secondment of classroom teachers, so that you've got people constantly involved in our national education bodies who have had that direct personal recent experience of being in a classroom?
Yes, undoubtedly. And I think, actually, to be fair to the inspectorate side of Education Scotland, there's already quite a well-developed associate inspector programme, which sees head teachers and senior leaders seconded out for school inspections. So they might accompany, for example, a team with the inspectorate on a secondary school inspection. That's hugely important, I think, to informing policy, but it's also important for their development as well. And I think to Mr Greer's point, certainly when I was in Education Scotland, so this is over 10 years ago now, there were a number of people who may not have been in school for some time and who had not delivered curriculum for excellence. And that's quite challenging, I think, when you're inspecting a school and you've not yourself delivered the qualification. So there is a really important opportunity to better give professional development opportunities to staff. One of the best, I've spoken about this in committee when we were last on committee together, one of the best pieces of professional development I undertook was being an SQA marker for 5 years. Having an understanding of the national standard made me a better teacher. Not everyone has an opportunity to mark for the exam organisation. You need to be let out of school. Your head teacher would need to find cover for you. And in a time where budgets are tight, that can be challenging. So we need to think again about the opportunities the qualifications body gives to the profession, because it's not just about being a service that runs qualifications. It has to better work with the profession. And obviously, I wasn't imposed during the pandemic, but I think a large part of the frustration in the system was that disconnect between the qualifications organisation and the profession that didn't just come about, I should say, as a result of COVID, but that had built up over many, many years.
Thanks, sir. You've actually preempted my last question. Was going to be about exactly that point. You shouldn't have to be an SQA marker to really understand the grading system, and yet we've had a lot of that feedback. You've made exactly that point already, so I'm happy to finish there, Convener, given time.
And can I move finally to questions from Liam Kerr, please?
Yes, thank you, Convener. On a similar note, actually, the consultation on the Future Education Bill, which would abolish and replace the SQA, closed in December. Now, previously, the Scottish Government's announced that an SQA replacement would be in place by, I think, 2025. Is the work that we've discussed today on curriculum or assessment reform dependent on reform of the SQA? And if so, what are the timescales?
No, it is not. So the curriculum improvement work I committed to in December is starting now. So we're getting going already with the maths element in relation to curriculum improvement. I expect to have recommendations with me towards the middle of the year, and then we're going to go out and test it with the profession. They have to be part of October. Mm-hmm. Yeah, they have to be part of informing the improvements. So just because I have delayed reform in relation to legislating for the new bodies doesn't mean we can't get going with curriculum improvement. And bluntly, to Mr Kerr's point, I think we have to, given the results from PISA at the end of last year.
Very grateful. What does the Cabinet Secretary, sticking with the SQA, what does the Cabinet Secretary define as the improved outcomes from having a new qualifications agency?
I'm not sure if I'll be able to give Mr Kerr a definitive list of outcomes, I suppose, but I do think that a new qualifications agency, to my point to Mr Greer, has to work better with the teaching profession. And in my experience in school, and actually on this committee, that was a major barrier in many instances to improving outcomes for our young people. You know, one of the best meetings I've had in recent times, I think I referenced this in the Chamber in December, was with the Scottish Association of Geography Teachers. And they came to me with a plan. They said, we don't need to completely throw out the whole qualification, but here are some changes we think would make the geography qualification more relevant. They talked me through it. I confess I'm not a geographer, but the suggestions they put forward were eminently sensible. And you could go to any professional association from any subject area in the secondary curriculum and you would have exactly the same feedback. That is the missing link at the current time, in my experience, that the profession is not engaged enough as it should be in the development of the qualifications. And actually, if you go back to Ken Muir's report, these are the things that we need to fix in relation to the outcomes from the new qualifications organisation.
Indeed. And noting that, does the SQA, as currently constituted, have a role in developing the future operating model of a new qualifications agency?
Itself at the current time?
Yeah, so does the SQA take a role in what the future would look like?
Of itself as an organisation or the qualifications?
Forgive me, Cabinet Secretary, does the SQA, so there are various bodies, there are various people involved in developing what a new operating model of a new qualifications agency might look like. Is the SQA involved also in developing that new model?
The current model?
The new one that will replace it?
It's feeding into it, but I think, to the member's point, I think he can correct me if I'm wrong, when I assumed post, I wanted to introduce an element of objectivity into this process, because I think the critique to government previously was that we can't allow organisations to reform themselves, which I accept. That's why we've made some changes to the governance approach, which looks at bringing actually some of Mr Day's work into the same space, which looks at me chairing a board whereby these organisations that have to reform all come together. So I think that may give some answer to the member's question. Of course, this organisation is going to not disappear to some extent, because there will still need to be a qualifications organisation, and we will still need a body that will run and administer our qualifications. So they have to feed into the process. But to the wider point, and I suppose the cultural shift, the organisation needs to become a bit more fleet of foot, from my experience. And that's why we will embed teacher voice, learner voice in some of the governance structures. But it also needs to listen to the profession, and I'm really keen to work with the organisation on how we take that forward.
Okay, thank you very much. And I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary and her officials for their evidence this morning. That concludes the public part of our proceedings. I now suspend the meeting to allow witnesses to leave, and the committee will then move into private session to consider the final agenda item. Thank you very much.